now, the greatest radio shows of all time.
Suspense.
The Shadow Node.
Washington calling David Harding, counter-spy.
Classic radio theater.
The Great Gildersleeve.
Fibber McGee and Molly.
Dragnet. Gunsmoke.
The Lone Ranger.
Now step back into our time machine with your host, Wyatt Cox.
Good evening, friends of the Inner Sanctum.
Criminal activity on this edition of the podcast with Brian Donlevy and Dangerous Assignment, Joe DeSantis in a mutual show Under Arrest, Sir Ralph Richardson and Sir John Gielgud in The Adventures of Sherlock Holmes, William Gargan as Barry Craig Confidential Investigator, Inner Sanctum Mysteries Depth and Death in the Depths, Jack Webb in One Out of Seven, and the most criminal of all, Lum and Abner. That's all coming up on this Tuesday edition, 6th day of February, 37th day of the year, and we have 329 days remaining till we get to 2025. Happy birthday, Massachusetts. They became the 6th state of the Union to ratify the Constitution on this date in 1788. New Jersey granted the first American railroad charter to a John Stevens. In 1843, the first minstrel show in the U.S. took place on this date at the Bowery Amphitheater in New York City. In 1862, Ulysses S. Grant gave the U.S. its first victory of the Civil War by capturing Fort Henry, Tennessee. The 20th Amendment of the Constitution went into effect, shortening the time from election to inauguration on this date in 1933. Jack Kilby of Texas Instruments filed the first patent for an integrated circuit in 1959. On that same date, at Cape Canaveral, the first successful test firing of a Titan intercontinental ballistic missile was accomplished. In 1971, and this may seem a little too earth-shattering for us to discuss, in the Apollo 14 mission on this date in 1971, Alan Shepard became the first person to hit a golf ball on the moon.
Well, Houston, while you're looking that up, you might recognize what I have in my hand is the handle for the contingency sample return. It just so happens to have a genuine six iron on the bottom of it. In my left hand, I have a little white pellet that's familiar to millions of Americans. Drop it down. Unfortunately, the suit is so stiff I can't do this with two hands, but I'm going to try a little sand trap shot here. And he got more dirt than ball that time. Got more dirt than ball. Here we go again.
That looked like a slice to me, Al.
There we go. Three of the die. One more. Miles and miles and miles.
Yeah, you put a golf ball on the moon, you'll have some intense records there. Alan Shepard, as it was heard by Americans on this date in 1971. In 1998, Washington National Airport renamed Ronald Reagan National Airport. 1999, Hillary Clinton became the first First Lady to run for and be elected to the United States Senate.
New York defined what was possible in the 20th century. And New York can make what seems impossible today possible in the 21st century. And that's why I want to be your senator from New York. Thank you all very much.
Hillary Clinton becoming a senator on this date in 1999. In 2018, Elon Musk's SpaceX Falcon Heavy, a super heavy launch vehicle, made its maiden flight. Passing away on this date in history, the world's foremost authority, Irwin Corey, actor James Whitmore, Carl Wilson of the Beach Boys, Vince Guaraldi, who created that wonderful music from A Charlie Brown Christmas, and we still enjoy to this date. Also film music composer, orchestra leader Hugo Montenegro, that great music from, what was it? The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly. That's what it was. And Danny Thomas, born on this date. Actor Joseph Cotten, we hear him periodically. Also singer Falco. The man who created Captain America, the Fantastic Four, and the Hulk, Jack Kirby. And Arthur Ashe.
Arthur Ashe was just plain better than most of us.
Former UN ambassador and mayor of Atlanta, Andrew Young, Arthur Ashe, passing away on this date in history. Among those born on this date, the Bambino, Babe Ruth.
Are 714 home runs the most you ever hit?
Well, that's quite a few, isn't it? Well, I tell you, in the old days, say back up to 1921 or 20, if your ball club needed one run, it was three men on base in the ninth inning, and for instance, I got up there and hit a home run, it didn't count for a home run. It only counted for one run driven in. Uh-huh. See, make the score 2-1 or 3-2, something like that. Well, I hit quite a few like that.
Babe Ruth, born on this date in history, along with Vice President Aaron Burr, the mistress of Adolf Hitler, Eva Braun, voice actor Thurl Ravenscroft, You're a Mean One, Mr. Grinch, Hungarian actress Zsa Zsa Gabor, Darling, British actor from the Avengers TV show, Patrick McNee, also actor Rip Torn, singer Bob Marley, Natalie Cole, and President number 40, Ronald Reagan.
This is Ronald Reagan speaking to you from Hollywood. You know me as a motion picture actor. But tonight I'm just a citizen, pretty concerned about the national election next month, and more than a little impatient with those promises the Republicans made before they got control of Congress a couple of years ago.
I can't help but think about how often had moments of accomplishment and triumph, as well as crisis and heartbreak, we came together in this way. A president giving his accounting to those under our system of government to whom he is accountable. We've shared a great deal together. For me, it's been a special relationship. Believe me, Saturdays will never seem the same. I'll miss you.
The weekly radio chats are so much missed by a president that's responsible. President Ronald Reagan, born on this date in history.
Hi, this is Jeff Foxworthy. It is now time for the birthday announcements. The following people are now officially older than dirt.
And among those still with us, BJ from MASH, Mike Farrell, is 85 today. Tom Brokaw is 84. The former teen idol, Fabian Forte, 81. She was Peggy Hill in King of the Hill. Kathy Najimy, 67. From The Parenthood, Robert Townsend, 67. Guns N' Roses lead man Axl Rose, 62. Rick Astley will never give you up, never let you down. Rick Astley, 58 today. And from Teen Wolf and Gotham, Crystal Reed is 39. And Tinashe Kachoingwe from Polar Express and 2 1/2 Men, Tinashe is 30 years old today. Those just a few of the people who celebrate the 6th day of February as their birthday. And if this happens to be your birthday...
Hi, we're the Four Freshmen, and we just want to say...
Happy birthday to you!
All right, we roll on here on this Tuesday Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox with an episode of Brian Donlevy's Dangerous Assignment from 74 years ago, February 6th, 1950, The Missing Japanese Weapons. That's up next here on this Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox podcast.
Alert today, alive tomorrow.
Plan now with your family for civil defense emergency action. Someday it may save your lives.
Join, work, and share together with others this knowledge of self-help. Civil defense, an American tradition.
And on this Tuesday Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox, Brian Donlevy in Dangerous Assignment. This goes back 74 years to February 6, 1950, the story of missing Japanese weapons.
Dangerous Assignment, starring Brian Donlevy as Steve Mitchell.
You sent for me, Commissioner?
Yes, sit down, Steve. I suppose you heard about Bill Thorne.
Yeah, they pulled his body out of a river in eastern Panama.
That's right. Bill was one of our best agents and one of your best friends, Steve. I figured you'd want to take over his assignment.
I do.
You've got it as of right now. And I'll give you the background quickly. Ruth, how about Steve's credentials?
I've got them already, Commissioner. Steve can pick them up at my desk.
Good. Here's a setup, Steve. Shortly before the Japanese surrender, an entire boatload of Japanese weapons disappeared. We have reason to think they're hidden somewhere in Panama, and that whoever has them is willing to sell to the highest bidder.
How many weapons are involved?
Enough to equip 3 divisions.
Well, Bill Thorne must have been getting warm.
Yes, that's obviously why he got killed. Steve, we can't afford to have a hidden cache of weapons that close to the canal.
Who do I work with down there?
Lieutenant Peters of the National Police in Panama City.
Any other contacts who might help me?
One. His name is Emil Fager. He owns a large plantation down there. Quite an influential man.
Can we trust him?
In this business, who knows? But he has done several favors for us in the past.
When does my plane leave?
30 minutes. Steve, I don't need to tell you about the danger involved. They've already killed Bill Thorne. They'll be gunning for you, too. As usual, you'll pose as a foreign correspondent. Actually, your job is to find those weapons.
Yeah, and find out who killed Bill Thorne.
Yes. Well, that's it. You've got your assignment, Steve. Good luck.
The National Broadcasting Company welcomes back to the air Dangerous Assignment, starring Brian Donlevy as Steve Mitchell, colorful, two-fisted government agent. At all those places of the world where danger and intrigue walk hand in hand, there you will find Steve Mitchell on another Dangerous Assignment. Steve Mitchell is en route to Panama City by plane. Meanwhile, on a plantation in eastern Panama, near the forbidding and sinister Darien country, 2 men sit hunched over a powerful radio receiver.
Steve Mitchell departed United States for Panama City. Believe he's taking over job of his late friend.
That does not surprise me, Guerrero. I did not think they would let the matter of the weapons drop.
We will try to give Mitchell the same reception here in Panama that we gave his friend Bill Thorne.
Yes. You know what to do, Correro. At the first opportunity.
Lieutenant Perez, I'm Steve Mitchell from the United States. Here are my credentials.
See, Senor Mitchell. They appear to be in order. You've just arrived?
Yeah. My plane landed about 30 minutes ago.
Please, sit down, Senor.
Thanks. Say, is it always this hot in Panama?
Oh, no, Senor. It gets much hotter than this.
Great.
I presume you wish information about Senor Bill Thorne?
That's right.
Well, I'm afraid there is very little I can tell you, Senor. Thorne's body was recovered from a river in the Darien country in eastern Panama.
Was he already dead when he was pulled out of the river?
No, not quite, but he lasted only a few seconds more.
Look, was he able to say anything at all about what had happened?
No, senor. He only mumbled something about San Miguel. Then he died.
San Miguel? What did he mean?
Well, I do not know, senor. It is very mystifying. However, there is an Indian village called San Miguel inland in the Darien region. Here, it is at this point on the map.
How would I go about getting to San Miguel?
Oh, senor, that is very bad country.
What do you mean?
Well, the Darien country to the east, it is very wild. One can travel only by train or boat. And the Indians are very savage. Many people who enter that country are never seen again.
It wasn't an Indian who killed Bill Thorne. But you still haven't told me how to get to San Miguel.
Then you are determined to go?
Of course.
In that case, I will accompany you. Now, let me see. I think we should notify Senor Fager of our intentions.
Fager?
Si. We will journey up this river, and here we will pass through land which is owned by him.
Oh.
It is customary to notify him when someone undertakes such a trip.
Would that be Emil Fager?
Si, Emil Fager. Why, do you know him, Senor?
I know of him. Matter of fact, I was told I might contact him for help.
Oh, he has always been very cooperative about such things. Yes, we will go see him. He happens to be here in Panama City at present. He is staying at the International Hotel.
Where's that?
On the Cinco de Mayo Plaza in the center of town. We can walk there.
In this heat?
Oh, but, senor...
Yeah, I know. It gets much hotter than this.
Hola, ¿qué tú haces por aquí? ¡Qué milagro!
I thought we would find Senor Fega here in the lobby. That is he, the fat gentleman sitting in that chair by the window.
He believes in service. I wish I had a guy to fan me.
See, that is Senor Fager. Good afternoon, senor.
Ah, Lieutenant Perez. But I fail to see anything good about the afternoon, sir, with this infernal heat.
Well, you should be accustomed to it by now, senor.
Oh, I seem to feel it more when I come into town, senor. On my plantation, it doesn't bother me. But here, I must take Pepito and his fan wherever I go. Pepito, turn around. Fan the gentleman.
Senor, I would like to introduce Senor Steve Mitchell, a correspondent from the United States.
Delighted to make your acquaintance, sir.
Mr. Fager.
Well, what can I do for you, gentlemen?
Senor Mitchell desires to see some of the Darien country. I have offered to take him up the river with me.
The Darien country? Oh, you're an adventurous man, Mr. Mitchell. That region is not generally considered to be suitable for an outing.
So I'm told. I understand you have a plantation somewhere up there.
Well, see, on this edge of the region, it's fairly civilized there, but beyond lies territory that not even I have ever set foot in. Pepito, you are lagging. Faster, faster.
You know, this is the closest thing to a breeze I've felt since I left home.
As we will be passing through your land part of the way, I thought I should ask your permission, Senor Fager.
Good answer, of course. Glad to have you, gentlemen. At least that portion of your journey will be safe. Would you like me to send one of my men with you?
I don't think that'll be necessary, Mr. Fager. Thanks just the same.
Oh, at least let me put one of my boats at your disposal.
Well, you are most kind, senor.
Not at all, Lieutenant. As you know, I am always willing to cooperate with the authorities in anything at all. Anything at all.
Wow. It isn't getting any cooler, Perez.
No, senor. As you see, the streets are nearly deserted this time of day. Everyone seeks refuge from the heat.
Yeah. I noticed that this street wasn't exactly crowded. Hey, here's a doorway. Let's get out of the sun a minute, huh?
Of course, senor.
What do you know?
What is it, senor?
Wouldn't you know it? 10 degrees hotter than a Turkish bath, and some joker builds a chimney on his house.
Chimney? But, senor, there are no chimneys in Panama City.
No. Look out in the middle of the street. See the shadow of that building across the way?
Well, that is no chimney, senor. Chimneys do not move.
Hey, that's a man up there on the roof.
He's got a knife. Get down, get down! It hit the door right over your head.
Yeah. 2 inches lower and I'd have gotten a haircut the hard way.
Yeah. Did you get a look at him?
Just a glimpse of his face.
The roofs are close together in this part of the city. He could be a block away by now.
Yeah.
Well, senor, it would appear someone objects to your presence in Panama City.
That doesn't surprise me much. Well, come on, Perez. Let's get outfitted and start that trip up the river to San Miguel. You know, this is not exactly like boating on the Potomac, Perez. Look at that jungle. I'd sure hate to get lost in there.
Oh, it is an easy thing to do, Senor Mitchell. The only trails in there are made by the Indians, and they are well concealed.
You say the Indians in this area are hostile?
Most of them. There isn't any intrusion on what they consider their country. And, of course, the Indians are not the only danger in there.
No?
There are always the snakes.
Snakes?
Oh, yes, senor. This jungle is full of them. Many varieties, but most of them are quite deadly.
Oh, fine.
Well, we should be getting close to San Miguel. We have but a few more hours of daylight, and because of the rocks, it is very dangerous to navigate the river at night.
Well, I'm not hankering to be out in this stuff at night. These mosquitoes don't help things either.
Mitchell, someone is shooting at us from the jungle.
Get down in the boat.
You see where it came from?
See where it came from? I can't even see where we're going.
We must keep control of the boat.
Yeah. As soon as he shoots again, I'll take a quick look over the side and see where we're going. Hey, that went right through the boat. Look, Perez, it doesn't matter where we're going. This boat's a death trap. I think we'd better slip over into the water on the other side of the boat here. We'll be a little more sheltered that way.
Si, senor. Look out. Huh? That rock ahead of us.
Yeah, get clear. Get clear.
Oh, the boat is done for. Into the water.
Okay. Yeah. Perez! Perez, where are you?
Right here, sir.
You okay?
Me.
Try to swim underwater. Head for the other bank. Perez, where'd the slug hit you?
Yeah. In the shoulder.
Here, let me get my arm under you. Yeah.
Mitchell, don't try to save me.
You're making a target of yourself.
Yeah. Here. Okay.
Yeah.
Got my arm under you now.
But Mitchell...
Shut up and relax. I'm going to try something behind this rock.
Yeah. Oh. Senor, I'm getting weaker.
Hold on, Perez. Just a little longer.
Yeah.
There. We made it. Good. This rock will shelter us from Trigger Boy for the time being. How you doing, Perez?
Oh, I'm afraid I've lost quite a little blood, senor.
Well, wad up your shirt and hold it over the wound.
See?
Yeah, that's it. Hey, I can touch bottom here. Look, just lay over on my shoulder and I'll carry you out of the water.
All right.
Here we go. We're going to be exposed for a second or two, but we can't help it. There. I don't think he can spot us in this underbrush. How far do you think we are from this village of San Miguel?
Oh, it can only be a mile or two.
Good. Okay. Come on, get up on my back now.
Oh, no, senor. Please do not try to carry me. Leave me here and send help for me.
Oh, fine. I'm sure the snakes around here would love to see you.
But you cannot carry me all that way.
Well, I'll admit playing piggyback with a sniper after us isn't my idea of fun. But at least we've got the river between us. Come on now. Here, up you go.
Yeah.
Can you see the village yet, Perez?
See, it is in that clearing just ahead.
Good. This is sure the longest mile I've ever walked in my life. Yeah, I see it now. Hey.
Hmm?
All the huts are up on stilts.
Extranjeros vienen!
Uh-oh. Looks like we've got a reception committee coming towards us.
The man in front, I think he is their chief. We had better stop here at the edge of the clearing.
Okay. I'll put you down here.
Yeah.
There. Can you stand all right?
Yes. Senor Mitchell.
Yeah.
For bringing me to safety, I... Gracias, senor.
Here they come.
Silencio!
What you want, senores?
Some help for my friend here and some information.
You come as friends?
Yes. Believe me, Chief, we're in no position to do harm to anyone right now.
Blas!
Si.
Have that one's wound cared for.
Si. Can you walk, senor?
Si.
Come with me.
I'll check with you in a couple of minutes, Perez.
Si, senor.
Thank you, Chief.
What you want to ask me, senor?
Chief, a friend of mine was killed near here a few days ago. His name was Thorne, Bill Thorne.
I remember him.
Well, he came to see you?
Si, senor.
Why?
He wanted to ask me about Mystery of San Miguel.
Mystery of San Miguel? Well, I guess he got killed trying to find out what that mystery was. I've taken over for him. Now, what can you tell me about it?
2-3 years ago, 20 of my best men walk into jungle.
Mm.
Disappear. Never see again.
They disappeared without a trace?
Si, senor.
Oh, why did they go into the jungle?
White man offer them job working for him in mine in jungle.
A mine? You know who the white man was?
No, senor.
Is the mine around here anywhere?
Si. It's down river not far from here. But mine is deserted.
Look, would you furnish me a guide who could take me to that mine?
Si. I will send Blas. He is best man I have.
Thanks, Chief. I'd like to start right now. I'd hate to be trying this alone, Blas. You can't even see these trails from 10 feet away.
Si, senor. We keep them well concealed. We do not wish enemies to use them.
You have any idea what kind of work these men from your village were doing at this mine we're heading for?
No, senor. Once I saw some of them going downriver on a large boat.
Could you see what was on the boat?
Big boxes.
Big boxes, huh? Yeah, that could have been the weapons.
Aye, here we are, senor.
What?
Here's the mine.
Where? I don't see anything.
right over there, senor.
Is that it?
Si.
No wonder I couldn't see it. It's all blown over with underbrush. Sure haven't been operating for a long time. Here, I'll take a look. Hey, the shaft's completely caved in. No chance of finding out what's down there now, I guess.
Senor.
Huh?
The birds.
What?
We are being followed.
What? Are you sure about that?
I am sure.
What was that?
Stand still, senor. Now I see him.
Who?
Look, over against that tree.
Holy smoke, what's that?
Iguana, senor.
What?
Iguana, a giant lizard.
You call that thing a lizard? It's 5 feet long.
Si.
Look at him go.
Si, senor.
Brother, remind me never to spend a vacation here. Well,
Wait. Birds do not stop singing for iguana. Listen.
Yeah, I hear it. Someone coming through the brush.
Senor, you get over behind that tree. I will lie beside the trail here with my machete.
Okay. Can you see anything?
See. He's a man. He's carrying a rifle.
Probably the same sniper.
Quiet. There it comes.
No!
See?
Brother, you sure made short work of him, Blas.
He would have made short work of us, sir.
Yeah. Hey, I recognize his face. That's the guy who chucked a knife at me in Panama City yesterday afternoon.
You know this man?
No. Here, maybe there's something here in his pockets that'll give us a lead on who he is. Just this picture.
A picture of himself?
Yeah. That girl he's with isn't bad either. Well, come on, Blas. Let's get back to the village. Look, I'm going to ask the chief if I can keep you with me to help me take Perez back to Panama City. I've got to get back there and make out my report.
Steve's report's coming in from Panama City, Commissioner.
Good. Let's have it, Ruth.
Here you are.
Great job you sent me on, Commissioner. To date, I've had a knife thrown at me, been shot at, and nearly drowned. Good Lord.
You know, that guy can get into trouble easier than anyone I know.
Even the lizards are chasing me.
He's just irresistible, I guess.
Perez wounded, but not seriously. Located mine, which looked like promising hiding place for weapons, till I found it had been deserted for years.
Here's the rest of it.
I'm back in Panama City with Perez now. On our way over to the International Hotel to notify Emil Fager about the loss of his boat. We'll keep you informed.
We are very sorry about the loss of your boat, Senor Vega.
Nonsense. It was unavoidable, Lieutenant. And I have other boats. You were both very fortunate to escape with your lives, gentlemen.
You can say that again, Mr. Vega. But at least that river was cool.
Where did you say this incident occurred, Senor Perez?
Oh, about 20 miles past your plantation, Senor.
Yes. That's bad country up there. Makes a perfect hiding place for outlaws and cutthroats. Any idea why that sniper should be shooting at the two of you, sir?
No, none.
Must have been a nasty wound you got, Senor Perez.
See, my shoulder still pains, but it is much better now.
Come on, Perez, we'd better be going. I'll see you later, Fager. And thanks again for the use of the boat.
Oh, you're quite welcome, sir. It is just unfortunate your adventure had such a disastrous ending. But do not hesitate to call on me again if you need anything.
Thank you. I looked up the registration papers on the deserted mine as you requested, Senor Mitchell.
What'd you find out?
Well, it was owned by Manuel Carrero, and the foreman was Eduardo Avila.
Either of those names mean anything to you?
No, not that of Manuel Carrero. But I do know Avila. He has been arrested several times this last year on charges of drunkenness. He frequents the bars on the Avenida Central.
Good. Let's go over there and see if we can run him down.
Hello?
There is Avila, Senor Mitchell. Over at the corner table with the woman.
Ah, well, our luck's good, Perez, finding him in the third bar we tried. Hey, Who's that girl he's with?
I do not know, senor. She's just a Blue Moon Queen.
A what?
Blue Moon Queen. That is what we call them here. Girls who frequent these bars and get men to buy drinks for them. Why do you ask, senor?
Because she happens to be in the picture I took out of the dead sniper's pocket.
What? Are you sure of that?
Take a look at it. Here.
See, si, you are right.
Come on.
Eduardo Avila.
What do you want?
As you know, I am Lieutenant Perez of the police.
What has Eduardo done?
I will ask the question, senorita.
I've done nothing.
Were you not once the foreman of a mine up the river near the edge of the Darien country?
That mine has not been operated for years.
What kind of a mine was it?
Why don't you leave me alone? All the time the police, they arrest me, lock me up. Why don't you leave me alone? All I want is to be left alone.
Avila, come back here.
Let him go for now, Perez. I want to talk to the little lady here.
What you want with me?
Take a look at this picture. Who's that man with you?
I do not know.
Come on, quit stalling.
I tell you, I do not know.
Senorita, allow me to point out, if you do not tell us, I will have to arrest you. I believe you are acquainted with our jail. I'm certain you would not like to return. Now, who is the man in that picture with you?
Correro.
What? Let's have that again.
Manuel Correro.
Mitchell.
Yeah. Thanks, senorita. Come on, Perez.
Senor Mitchell, Manuel Correro was the man who was listed as the owner of that mine.
Yeah, the same guy who threw a knife at me and was shooting at us in the river. I wish he'd lived long enough to fill in a few details.
After you, senor.
Thanks.
What do you think of this foreman we just talked to, Avila? He impresses me as a man who knows something he is drinking to forget.
Yeah. I wonder if he's trying to forget those 20 natives who disappeared from San Miguel. You know, all of this seems to tie into that mine. Have you still got those registration papers on it?
See, in my office.
Good. I want to take a look at them.
Here are the papers on the mine, senor. As you see, Carrero is listed as the owner, Avila is foreman. But now that Carrero is dead, I'm afraid...
Wait a minute.
Hmm?
What's this?
Oh, that is a map of the area surrounding the mine and a diagram of the mine. It is required by law to...
Hey.
What is it, senor?
Take a look at this diagram. See? Here's the mine shaft indicated here.
Hmm? The one you discovered to be caved in.
Yeah. But look over here. Right around the bend of the river.
Oh, another entrance to the mine.
Yeah, a side door. Look, can you get me another boat?
Why, of course, but...
That Indian guide, Blas, is still here in Panama City, too.
Senor Mitchell, you think the weapons are stored in that mine after all?
I don't know. That's what I'm going back up the river to find out.
We are very near to the shore, senor.
Yeah, Blas. I'm keeping the boat in as close as I can. I don't want to miss that mine entrance. We should be getting warm, according to this map. Look, there's a bend in the river just ahead.
Yes, senor, I see the entrance. What? Right over there, in the side of the river bank.
Huh? Oh, yeah. Brother, you'd never spot that in a million years unless you knew right where it is. It's all covered with underbrush.
See?
Okay. Tie up to that branch. We'll take a look.
See? See? There.
Okay, come on. Well, here we are.
It's very dark in town.
Yeah. I got a flashlight. I'll go first. It's a cinch this part of the mine hasn't been abandoned for years. Look at the footprints in the dirt. Wait a minute. The tunnel takes a turn to the left here.
See, it is widening out a little, senor.
Yeah, I think... Hold it. Holy smoke. Look at that. Rifles, machine guns, grenades. The works. Well, I've got to hand it to Carrero. He picked a good hiding place. Let's have a look.
Senor, look. Huh? Look on the ground there.
Bones. They're all around us.
Yeah. Skeletons. A lot of them. Yeah, I guess that solves the mystery of San Miguel, Blas. 20 men from your village walked into the jungle and disappeared. 20 men who were hired to bring the weapons here and then were killed to shut their mouths.
One of those skeletons, senor, once was my brother.
I didn't know that, Blas. I'm sorry.
Senor,
hmm?
Somebody is in this mine with us.
Well, I'll douse the light.
Your light is not necessary. I will furnish the illumination. No, no. Stand quite still, both of you.
Well, Emil Fager, complete with gun.
At your service, Mitchell. Or should I say, you are at mine.
So you're the big boy in the deal, huh?
I knew it was only a question of time until you discovered this entrance to the mine, Mitchell. So I thought it expedient to await you here and give you the reception you so richly deserve.
Manuel Carrera was just fronting for you with the mine, huh?
He was an employee of mine, and a very inefficient one, as it turns out. Ah, stay close together. I want to keep you both in the beam of my flashlight.
This man, senor.
Yes, boss?
He is the one who killed the men of my village and my brother.
That's right. He's the one, Blas.
Wait, you. Stay where you are. Stand back, I say.
Watch out, Blas. He'll shoot.
What happens to me does not matter.
Get back. Drop that machete.
I avenge my dead brother. What?
Throw your machete. Throw it.
See?
You knocked the gun out of his hand. I've got it.
Oh, let go of me, Mitchell. You sure. No, let go of your right. Now.
You okay, Blas? See, this wound is nothing. Just my leg.
Well, this is the second time you've saved my life, Blas. I hope it's the last time. Believe me, I don't want to make a habit of it.
Senor, this man Fager, it would give me great pleasure to kill him.
Yes, I know how you feel. But at least he's going to be out of circulation from now on. He's out of the weapon-selling business for good. Well, I guess this puts a new twist on an old saying.
What is that, senor?
He who lives by the sword shall perish by the machete. Oh, come on, Blas. Let's get out of here.
Dangerous Assignment, starring Brian Donlevy as Steve Mitchell. Dangerous Assignment is written by Bob Reif, with music by Bruce Ashley and directed by Bill Karn. Be with us next week at this time when Brian Donlevy, starring as Steve Mitchell, will embark on another Dangerous Assignment. Fred Allen visits Bob Hope. Be sure to hear him tomorrow on NBC.
After a bobble like that, I don't feel so bad because I've done a lot of them myself just like that. Fred Allen tomorrow. Prato. Yeah, I've done that. February 6, 1950, 74 years ago, Brian Donlevy, Dangerous Assignment, here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. I know some of you say, well, why do you make so many boo-boos on your show? And it's like, because I made a boo-boo. And I just... You keep going forward. You know, it'd be very easy if I stopped every time I made a mistake and redid it, but that's not real live radio, you know? I mean, that's the way it always was. All right, we're going to head over to Mutual for an episode of a fine show, Under Arrest, starring Joe DeSantis in what I believe was his only starring vehicle. 75 years ago, February 6, 1949, the Sam Carver case. That's up next on this Tuesday, Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. First, I want to tell you tomorrow is going to be comedy. Jack Benny, Bob Hope, Burns and Allen. People are funny, Groucho in You Bet Your Life, an episode of The Great Gildersleeve, and we'll check in and see what's going on with Claudia. That'll be coming up on our next Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox on Wednesday. But right now, Under Arrest, following these important messages. Just when you thought it couldn't get any better, Mike Lindell and MyPillow are launching the MyPillow 2.0. When Mike invented MyPillow, it had everything you could want in a pillow. Now, nearly 20 years later, he discovered a new technology that makes MyPillow even better. The MyPillow 2.0 has the patented adjustable fill of the original MyPillow, and now with a brand new fabric that's made with a temperature-regulating thread, the MyPillow 2.0 is the softest, smoothest, and coolest pillow you'll ever own. and more great news on the MyPillow half-price special with promo code Wyatt. MyPillow 2.0 with its temperature-regulating technology, 100% made in the USA, 10-year warranty, 60-day money-back guarantee. Go to MyPillow.com, click on the radio podcast square to get the MyPillow 2.0 half-price special, or call 1-800-928-4715, 1-800-928-4715 to get the MyPillow half-price special. And remember that promo code Wyatt, that's available on anything on the MyPillow website. So use them if you have a mind to. If you got a dog, they got some great dog beds there. I've seen them. They're wonderful. They're delightful. Now, Joe DeSantis under arrest, a program from the Mutual Broadcasting System from 75 years ago, February 6, 1949, the Sam Carver murder case.
Mutual presents Under Arrest.
Into your cells.
Criminals behind bars. Under Arrest, the story of Police Captain Jim Scott's fight against crime.
Captain Scott.
Harry Gavin, Jim.
Yeah?
I'm at Madame Cherini's.
Great. Aren't you supposed to be on duty?
I am. I'm sitting up with a corpse.
Has the corpse got a name?
Sure has. Jerome K. Wade.
Jerome K. Not the gun manufacturer.
That's right.
The fellow who used to be partners with Sam Carver?
On the button. He's been shot.
Who did it?
Sam Carver.
Oh, you're crazy. Sam Carver's been dead for 4 years.
Yeah, I know.
Now, look, Gavin. From what you tell me, an important man's been murdered. I don't like to joke about such things.
I'm not kidding. Madame Cherini's a medium. She swears Sam Carver did it.
A medium?
Yeah, one of those people who bring back the dead. Looks like she brought back Sam Carver. Cute, huh?
I didn't think it was cute. The Sam Carver case had been looked upon as a suicide. Carver was partners with Wade in the gun factory, and it was his job to inspect the guns before shipment. He passed a defective bunch. They were shipped to the Army. Some of the boys at Okinawa got a rough deal when the guns didn't function as called for, and the incident created quite a scandal. Carver wrote a full confession, then blew his brains out in the library of his home. Only one thing didn't jibe. We never could locate the gun. Madame Cherini's place was located over the Red Parrot Bar and Grill. You had to pass through the bar to reach the back steps.
Hey, where do you think you're going?
Get my fortune told. I have a date with Madame Cherini.
A wise guy, huh? Well, if I were... Oh, excuse me. Didn't know you wore a badge.
That's okay. Which way is it?
Turn right through the door there, and it's one flight up at the head of the stairs.
Thanks.
Hello, Cal.
Oh, Larry. Where is it?
Right here. That third eye in the middle of his head is a bullet hole.
Thanks. Did you find a gun to go with it?
No, Jim, and I've been all over the room.
No gun?
That's right. Just like it was with his partner, Sam Carver. This is Madame Cherini.
Oh?
This is a terrible thing to happen, Captain. I've been practicing for 30 years, and I never had any trouble before.
It's always the first time.
Oh, believe me, Captain, I run a respectable place. Such a thing has never happened to me.
Nothing happened to you. Not yet. It happened to Wade. Were you here when he was shot?
Yes and no.
Yes and no?
I was in my trance. Mr. Wade wanted to communicate with the spirit of his dead partner. We held a seance. I remember nothing. I just reached through to my control.
Control?
The spirit who makes my contacts for me, Kathy. Communication was established. The next thing I knew, I heard a shot. It penetrated the veil, and I came back to Earth once more. The room was pitch black except for a light behind me. I turned and saw him. Just as plain as I see you now. It was Sam Carver, a gun in his hand. Oh, it was a beautiful materialization. Beautiful.
Yes, no doubt. What happened then?
It vanished right into thin air. Of course, it couldn't stay once I was my conscious self.
Of course.
I turned on the light. The switch is right here under the table.
Oh?
Mr. Wade was exactly opposite me. He had a look on his face, a look that I'll never forget. His mouth was open as though he were about to say something. Then he toppled out of his chair. Just as he is now.
You were conducting a seance?
Yes.
You need more than two people for a seance. Who else was here?
Mrs. Wade and Mrs. Carver.
Where are they now?
Mrs. Carver took Mrs. Wade home.
You mean Mrs. Wade saw her husband shot and she left just like that?
Oh, she was hysterical. She kept screaming about divine judgment and our husband got what he deserved. Benny might be able to tell you more about it. He helped her out.
Benny?
The bartender downstairs. He came running up just as soon as he heard the shot. Do you want to talk to him?
Yeah. Yeah, go get him, Larry.
Jack.
I think it might not be such a bad idea to question this Benny. While Gavin went to get the bartender, I took a look around the room. Nothing unusual about it. No secret trapdoors, sliding panels, nothing like that. There were heavy plush hangings, but they covered bare walls only. A low-hanging chandelier hung over the round table, and the light switch, as she said, was under the table. But you couldn't see any props, nothing to create contrived effects. Madame Cherini herself didn't look the part of the conventional medium, except for the fact that she was dressed completely in black and had a pair of the deepest, blackest eyes I've ever seen.
Here he is, Captain.
Hello, Benny.
Captain?
Madame Cherini tells me you rushed up to the room as soon as you heard the shot. Is that right?
Yep.
Why?
Why?
Weren't you afraid of getting shot yourself?
Oh, I see what you mean, Captain. Well, no, frankly, I didn't think of that. Madame Cherini's a good friend of mine. I only thought she might be in trouble.
And you're not afraid of guns?
Not as much as most people, I guess. In a way, I'm kind of used to them.
Where did you get used to them?
Okinawa.
Okinawa?
Yeah, there was a war. Do you remember?
Yes, I remember, Benny. I also remember a certain ugly incident. Bad guns delivered to our boys in a certain company. Could be some of your buddies died on that account. Jerome K. Wade and Sam Carver manufactured those guns. I'm not saying Wade didn't deserve to die, Benny.
I ain't saying he didn't deserve it either. I think that... Hey, why look at me? I didn't do it.
There was nobody in the room but the women when you entered, and nobody could have passed you on the stairs. Maybe you didn't run into the room at all, Benny. Maybe you were here all the time.
Nuts, I was down at the bar waiting on my customers till I heard that shot.
Why couldn't it have...
Yes, exactly. Why couldn't it have been one of the women?
I don't think so. As I remember seances, you all hold hands around the table. Isn't that right, Madame Cherini?
That's right, Captain Scott.
And Wade held each of the women by the hand, and they in turn held the hands of Madame Cherini. Doesn't seem possible, unless all three women were in league to kill Wade. In that case, the other two could have released Madame Cherini, but that seems like too long a shot.
Yeah? Well, then maybe you can explain how I got to look like Sam Carver, huh? They all agree that it was the ghost of Sam Carver who killed Wade.
Who do you mean all?
Mrs. Carver, Mrs. Wade, and Madame Cherini here.
That's right, Captain. We all recognized him. There couldn't have been any doubt that it was Sam Carver.
Sam Carver's been dead for 4 years. Yet you're sure you recognized him. You must have known him well.
Very well. Sam Carver was interested in spiritualism. Mr. Wade always used to laugh at him.
Yet you claim it was Wade who asked for this seance. And it was here he was murdered. Now, who killed him?
Sam Carver.
Bunk. Dead men don't go around killing people.
In my profession, Captain, you find out that dead people are not quite as dead as they seem.
I got a funny feeling as I looked at the corpse. There was something in the expression, kind of fixed smile, and the bullet hole Larry Gavin had described as a third eye. For a moment in the dim light, I could have sworn the dead man winked. But it's my job to catch live murderers, not ghosts. Jerome K. Wade was killed by a slug from a .32. Nothing ghostly about that. But as far as the gun was concerned, it might just as well have been ectoplasm. I warned Madame Cherini and Benny, the bartender, not to leave town. Lieutenant Gavin went to look up Mrs. Wade and get her story. Myself, I went to pay a call on Mrs. Sam Carver.
Captain Scott, I'm so sorry to have kept you waiting.
Quite all right, Mrs. Carver. Naturally, you're upset.
Naturally. There's Sam and poor Jerry. Would you care for a drink? I think I need one.
Thank you. I don't. She looked anything but upset. Mrs. Carver must have been quite a beauty in her day, and her day was not quite past. She moved like an animal with a lithe, sensuous grace. She smiled invitingly and sank down on the couch beside me, sipping her drink.
Pity we have to meet always under these circumstances.
Isn't it? I won't pretend I'm exactly grief-stricken about Jerry Wade. He was just as responsible as my husband. Even more so for that arms shipment. Yet poor Sam took all the blame.
What happened tonight? Exactly.
Probably just what you already heard. Mr. Wade invited me to attend this seance.
I thought Mr. Wade didn't believe in such things.
No, but he knew I did.
Oh?
Sam and I were always great believers in spiritualism, and especially in Madame Cherini.
Well, what was Wade's idea?
To convince me he had nothing to do with Sam's passing. I've always suspected something peculiar about my husband's death. I could never quite believe that Sam committed suicide, although it was I who found the body and the gun was right next to his hand.
That gun? What happened to it?
It simply disappeared.
Like the murderer disappeared tonight?
Murderer? I'm sorry. The truth is, Captain, I don't like my husband being called a murderer.
Your husband? Oh, you mean the ghost.
I saw it with my own eyes. So did the Wades and Madame Cherini. There couldn't have been any disguise.
Well, it was dark in the room.
There was a light around him. He was pale and his eyes were burning. He looked straight at Jerry Wade. The same gun was in his hands.
The same gun? How do you know?
Don't ask me how, I just knew.
Yes, go on.
He looked straight at Wade, and I heard Wade say in a strange, broken voice, "No, no, Sam, I didn't mean to do it. I didn't mean to, honest." And then...
Yes?
My husband uttered one word, "murderer," and fired. Madame Cherini awoke, and my husband disappeared.
With the gun?
Of course.
Now, look here, Mrs. Carver. That was no ghostly bullet which killed Jerry Wade. It was a real bullet like the one which killed your husband. By the way, who was present in this house the night your husband was shot?
Was shot? You don't think he killed himself then?
I'm not sure. In any case, he was shot. I'm asking you who was here.
Well, there were Mr. and Mrs. Wade, my son.
Your son?
John. He'd just come home from college. There was quite an argument between him and his father. It was on account of that scandal about the guns.
Where is he now?
Away at school, at Yale.
Yes, go on. Anybody else?
Oh, yes, of course. There was Madame Cherini. She stayed to dinner. We were going to have a seance later.
Who was the last person who saw your husband alive?
Madame Cherini, I think. She had a talk with Sam in the library. Sam was very upset about the argument with John. Madame Cherini was his advisor.
You don't look like the mother of a grown son.
Thank you, Captain. Are all policemen so gallant?
I imagine they would be. With you.
Thank you again. Are you sure you don't care for a drink?
Quite sure.
Too bad, Captain. We could both do with a bit of relaxation.
It was late when I got to my office next morning. Larry Gavin had seen Mrs. Wade and her story checked with those of Madame Cherini, Benny, and Mrs. Carver in every particular, even to the exact words used by her husband and the ghosts. Lieutenant Gavin had his own theory about the crime, and I wasn't too sure he was wrong.
Jim, I say it's all hypnosis. This medium sets up the mood, gets them all into a frame of mind where they're ready to believe anything. She shot Wade. It was dark in that room. How else could anybody plug him right in the middle of the forehead without being close up and knowing exactly where he was sitting?
Well, maybe an ordinary guy couldn't, but a ghost could.
Now, don't tell me you're going soft in the head, too.
Well, all the stories check. They couldn't all have been in on a plot to kill Jerry Wade.
I don't say they were. I'm saying the old gal hypnotized him. It adds up.
Maybe. I'd like to check with ballistics first. Captain Scott, get me the lab.
Yes, sir. Yes?
Captain Scott, did you check the Wade bullet against the bullet in the Carver file?
Yes, I did, Captain.
Well?
It's from the same gun, Captain. There's no doubt about it.
Are you sure it's from the same gun?
Positive.
Thanks.
Well, that clinches it. It must be the medium.
Why?
Wasn't she there the night Carver was shot?
Right.
Aren't all these mediums pretty good sleight-of-hand artists?
Right.
Wouldn't it have been a simple matter for a good magician to divert attention and pick up the gun at Carver's hand?
Right.
And wouldn't she use the same gun to kill Wade?
Wrong.
Why not?
Why should she plan a murder in her own home, where everything points against her?
So she could blame it on a ghost.
What motive would she have in killing Wade?
He thought she was a phony. He was an enemy of Sam Carver's, one of her oldest friends.
Not enough. Nobody risks the chair for that.
Then what do you think? The ghost did it?
Maybe.
Oh, have you gone nuts?
Maybe. Get me the Red Parrot Bar and Grill.
What are you going to do?
Make an appointment with the ghost.
Oh.
Hello?
Benny, Captain Scott.
Oh, yeah, Captain.
Could you call upstairs and bring Madame Cherini to the phone?
Don't have to call her, Captain. She's right here.
Oh, well, you know, she's right there.
Madame Cherini, this call is for you. Take it here.
Yes, Captain Scott?
Madame Cherini, you claim you brought back the spirit of Sam Carver last night. Materialized, I think, is the word you used.
Yes, Captain.
Then, could you materialize this spirit again for me?
I don't think so. Why should you want me to do that?
I'd like to remind you, Madame Cherini, this ghost is wanted for murder.
Oh, nonsense, Captain. You can't electrocute a ghost.
We can try.
I won't do it.
Madame Cherini, I'm afraid you don't realize your position. If you're a faker, then the ghost killer is something cooked up by you, and you're under suspicion of murder. If you're on the level, it's up to you to prove it by producing the ghost.
Spirit materializations are not easy. I may not be successful.
Well, that would be too bad for you.
The atmosphere has to be propitious.
What's wrong with the atmosphere?
There's too many policemen. They're all over the place. Spirits are allergic to policemen.
Well, send them away.
I can't rely upon you for that.
You've got my word.
All right, then.
When?
Tonight. Tomorrow morning, rather. Say about 3 a.m.
Why so late?
I want the circumstances to be favorable. I don't want any noise from downstairs. At 3 a.m., the bar will be closed.
Okay, you've got a deal.
One more thing.
What is it?
We'll need at least two others, sympathetic spirits. I think I can get Mrs. Carver.
Fine. How about Mrs. Wade?
Oh, I'm afraid she's too upset. I have it. We'll use Benny.
The bartender? Is he sympathetic with spirits?
You ought to be. Dishes enough of them out.
Shut up.
What is that?
I'm sorry, Madame Cherini. I wasn't talking to you. Okay, it's a date, 3 a.m.
Another thing. You must purify your mind.
Oh? Well, how do I do that?
Go into seclusion.
Seclusion?
Goodbye.
Goodbye. Larry, who have you got trailing Madame Cherini?
Hennessy.
Where is he now?
Across the street in a cigar store at Maple and Clark.
Phone him. Tell him not to lose sight of Madame Cherini for a minute. It's urgent.
Okay. Where are you going?
Into seclusion. You heard what Madame Cherini said.
Where can I reach you?
My room. Phone me if it's important. Hello?
Jim, Larry Gavin, and this is important.
Yes?
Hennessy's been telling Madame Cherini she's gone to Mrs. Carver's house.
Only natural. She's inviting her to the seance.
She's been in there with her for over an hour. If all she wanted was to invite her, she could have used the phone.
I see. Okay, I'll take care of it.
You going to the Carver house?
No, I'll wait for Madame Cherini at the bar under her room.
Is that the way to purify your mind?
It's my way. Did you call the boys off?
Yes, Captain. Do you think it's smart?
I'll let you know after tonight. All right, if anything comes up, I'll be at the bar.
Boy, I wish I were a captain.
Oh, good evening, Captain. What's your pleasure?
Anything with the original label? Madame Cherini told you about the seance?
Yeah.
Ever been to one of those things before?
Yeah, lots of times, lots of times. I'll have to hold your hand tonight, Captain. You mind?
Oh, not so long as somebody holds your other hand.
Here it is, Captain.
Well, here's mud in your eye.
Not mud, Captain. Ectoplasm.
Captain Scott, I didn't expect to find you here.
Just checking up, Madame Cherini, making sure everything's all right for the seance. But shouldn't you be resting yourself?
Well, even mediums can use a little fresh air.
Is that all you went out for? Fresh air?
And ask Mrs. Carver to attend.
Will she?
Yes.
Fine.
This is hardly the atmosphere for you before a seance. You should be alone with your thoughts.
I was just going, but just one question. Mrs. Carver told me you spoke to her husband shortly before his death.
Yes?
Did he sound to you like a man who was going to commit suicide?
No.
Yet he left a suicide note.
Not a suicide note, Captain Scott. A confession. There's a difference.
Suppose it weren't suicide. Have you any theory about what might have happened?
Well, this is only a supposition, mind you, but in the light of recent events...
Like the ghost of Sam Carver returning to shoot Jerry Wade?
Exactly. There was a big argument at the Carver house the night he was killed. His son, John, wanted both Wade and Carver to confess and take the consequences. Shortly afterward, both men retired to the library.
And what happened?
Well, I wasn't there. I can only suppose.
Yes?
Wade could have pretended to be convinced that it was best for them both to write full confessions.
Then what?
Once the confessions were written, Wade could have shot him and placed the gun near his hand. Then all Wade would have to do was sneak out through a side exit, taking his own confession with him and leaving Carver's. It would look to everyone as though Sam Carver had taken his own life in remorse.
And what could have happened to the gun?
Oh, Wade would have been afraid of his prints on the gun. He could have pocketed it later while no one was looking.
Or someone else could have picked it up. Yourself, for instance.
What do you mean?
Skip it. Did you tell Wade about your theory?
I did make certain suggestions.
Enough to convince the unbelieving Wade to attend a seance? Now, this is only a theory, mind you, Madame Cherini, but I'm going to be as generous with you as you are with me. Suppose you were the one who lifted the gun. Suppose you weren't an authentic medium, and suppose you wanted to frighten Wade into a confession of guilt. A confession only you would be able to force.
Why should I want to do that?
It's an ugly word, Madame Cherini. Blackmail.
Well, there's an uglier word, Captain Scott. Murder. If such was my intention, why should I kill the goose that lays the golden eggs?
Well, it's only a theory, Madame Cherini. I was only supposing you were a fake. You are an authentic medium, aren't you?
Of course, Captain. But you'll find that out tonight, won't you?
I hope to find out a lot of things tonight. It was uncanny. I now understood the purpose of the curtains on the walls, and the dark dress worn by the medium was to absorb even the faintest suggestion of light. Try as I would, my eyes could not penetrate the darkness. I sat directly opposite Madame Cherini. Mrs. Carver held my left hand, and I could feel her knee brush mine under the table. Benny held my right hand. The medium held theirs. The circle made a chain of communication that was almost electrical. Through the hands of those next to me, I could feel the medium stiffen as she went into a trance. She began to moan and then called upon her control, the spirit who was a guide in the other world.
Oh. Oh. Kathy. Kathy. Are you there? Kathy. Kathy, answer me. Two raps if you can come through. Three if there is interference. Do you hear me? Good. Are the channels clear tonight? Two raps, yes. Three, no. I will speak no more. Mrs. Carver will ask you questions, and you will answer her through me. Is that clear? Kathy, can you hear me? My husband with you? He is here. Can you make him materialize? Kathy, can you hear me? Yes. Can you make my husband appear?
Mine tightly, and I felt the bartender's hand stiffen. I strained my ears, anxious to catch the slightest sound. I thought I heard the creaking of the hall door, but it might have been the wind. We sat tense, holding our breaths.
Kathy!
I... couldn't believe my eyes. Slowly, a circle of light began to form at the other end of the room. A man's head and shoulders were framed in the light as though suspended in midair. The face was supernaturally pale. The eyes, dark and glowing.
Sam! Captain Scott is here. He's a policeman. Show him. Show him what you did last night.
From nowhere, a hand appeared. A hand with a gun. The figure uttered one word.
Murderer.
I heard a click. I crashed to the floor, sweeping Mrs. Carver down with me. There was a flash, and the shot reverberated through the room like a thunderbolt. Under cover of the darkness, I lunged toward the figure with the gun. He seemed to be running toward the fire escape window. There was a crash as the window broke. I pulled my gun and started after him. Too late, I realized I'd been tricked. The so-called specter had thrown something through the window, probably the gun, and then made for the hall door leading to the stairs. I heard him go running down the stairs.
Madame Cherini! Madame Cherini! Put on the lights!
What is it? What's happened?
Put on the lights. The switch. Under the table.
Mrs. Carver found the switch. For a moment, I could not get used to the glare. When I was able to focus my eyes, I saw Madame Cherini on the floor.
She's dead.
The hole was in back of the head this time. Ghost or no ghost, our murderer was a dead shot. And then I noticed Benny was gone.
Down the stairs!
I was about to follow when I heard a noise in the hall. Somebody was coming up.
Okay, Chief. Here's your ghost.
John! Oh, John!
No doubt about it. The ghost was John Carver, Mrs. Carver's son. It explained the resemblance to Sam. The resemblance had fooled Mrs. Wade and trapped her husband into blurting out a confession. John Carver was dressed all in black. The inside of his black top coat was smeared with phosphorescent paint from the waist up. In the darkness of the room, all he had to do was to open his coat slightly to get the ghostly glow we had all seen.
He nabbed him as he came charging outside. He almost got away in the dark. It's a good thing his coat was open.
Good thing you disobeyed my orders and was here to catch him. Well, what have you got to say for yourself, John?
It wasn't his fault. He didn't know what he was doing.
No, it's all right, Mother. Yes. I killed Wade. He deserved to die.
And the medium?
Madame Cherini started the whole thing. She knew I never believed my father committed suicide. She came to me with a plan for trapping Wade into a confession. Got me to play the ghost.
Was Madame Cherini who gave you the gun?
Yes, she had smeared it with some of that shiny paint to scare Wade. That was my idea, too, at first. But when I heard Wade admitting his guilt, practically confessing he murdered my father, something snapped inside of me. I pulled the trigger. I'm a good shot.
We know that much.
I hid behind the curtain. When Benny took Mother and Mrs. Wade down, I stole after them. The bar was crowded. All eyes were on Mrs. Wade, who was hysterical. As they left through the front door, I slipped in, mixed with the crowd, and made my getaway.
Why did you kill Madame Cherini?
She came to the house. She was furious because I'd shot Wade. Said something about killing the goose who laid the golden eggs. It was evidently her intention to blackmail him. Wade was dead, so she chose to blackmail me instead through Mother.
John. John, why did you?
My mother had nothing to do with all this. I couldn't stand by and see that woman tortured.
I know. And I'm not saying I don't understand, son. But no man is big enough to take the law into his own hands. Ready to go, Larry?
I'll set him.
Take your prisoner.
Under arrest.
Into your cells.
All prisoners present and accounted for.
You have just heard Under Arrest, presented by Mutual, a new series featuring Joe DeSantis as Police Captain Jim Scott. Under Arrest is directed by Martin Mockner. Today's drama was written by Norman Lessing. Original music is composed and played by Milton Kay. Madame Cherini was played by Virginia Payne. Mrs. Carver by Linda Watkins. John Carver by Leon Janney. Lieutenant Gavin by Carl Eastman. And Benny by Annie Donnelly. All names of persons used in Under Arrest are fictitious. Any resemblance to names of actual persons, living or dead, is coincidental. Broadcast engineer, Cy Paget. Sound effects, Ronnie Harper and Walt Shaver. Your announcer is Jack Curtis. This program came from New York. Straight Arrow, the thrilling story of an Indian's adventures on the western ranges, becomes a Top Mutual feature tomorrow and every Monday evening. You can enjoy Straight Arrow, and then stay tuned for intriguing mystery with the famous Sherlock Holmes, another Monday night highlight on the world's largest network. This is the Mutual Broadcasting System.
And there you have it, 75 years ago, February 6, 1949, Under Arrest here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Can I ask you to visit our webpage, classicradio.stream, where you can stream our shows, learn about building a classic radio collection of your own. You can find our social media links there. And if you'd like to support the podcast, you can buy me a coffee or purchase something there from the webpage. You'll see all sorts of things. And we do get a little bit of jingle in the pocket from those. All those items at classicradio.stream. There are DVDs, there are CDs. There's also a couple of interesting radios that might be of interest to you. Find those at classicradio.stream. Okay, we will head overseas to London for the Adventures of Sherlock Holmes. That'll be next here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox.
This is basic civil defense information from the Department of Defense, Office of Civil Defense, Washington. If the United States should be attacked with nuclear weapons, it's almost certain that our networks of warning stations would detect incoming bombers or missiles in time for you to reach shelter or at least take cover. You may receive warning of an attack by radio, television, or through the outdoor warning system in your community. It's important that you learn to recognize the attack warning signal and not confuse it with any other. In most places, the standard attack warning signal is a 3 to 5 minute wavering sound or a series of short blasts on whistles, horns, or other devices. Either of these signals means that an actual enemy attack has been detected, and you should take protective action immediately. Find out from your local civil defense office the attack warning system that will be used in your community.
And coming up tomorrow on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox, Jack Benny, Bob Hope, George and Gracie, People Are Funny, You Bet Your Life, The Great Gildersleeve, and Claudia. But right now, we head to a show that originated through the BBC, The Adventures of Sherlock Holmes, starring Sir Ralph Richardson and Sir John Gielgud, as it was originally broadcast 69 years ago, February 6th, 1955.
The Adventures of Sherlock Holmes, the original and immortal stories of Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, dramatized anew, with Sir Ralph Richardson as Dr. Watson and Sir John Gielgud in the role of Sherlock Holmes.
Week of November, in the year 1895, a dense yellow fog settled down upon London. From the Monday to the Thursday, I doubt if it was ever possible to see the opposite houses from our window in Baker Street. The first of these 3 days, Sherlock Holmes spent in music, and in cross-indexing his huge book of criminal references. But when, for the fourth time, we saw the greasy, heavy brown swirl still drifting past us and condensing in oily drops on the window panes, Holmes' whole impatient nature could endure such drab existence no longer. It was fortunate for both of us that there suddenly arrived for him a telegram.
Mycroft, Watson, it's from Mycroft, thank heaven.
Your brother Holmes?
Of course. You remember him from that affair of the Greek interpreter, of course.
Oh, of course, yes. Even if it's difficult to think of you with a family.
Oh.
You're an isolated phenomenon.
No, not so long as Mycroft thrives. Believe it or not, Watson, Mycroft is an even more remarkable man than I am.
What does this remarkable brother of yours do in Whitehall? I seem to remember he's some kind of post under the government.
Under? My dear Watson, Mycroft is the government.
Oh, come, my dear.
He draws £450 a year, remains a subordinate, with no ambitions of any kind, and yet the same great powers, which I have turned to the detection of crime, make Mycroft the central clearinghouse of every fragment of vital knowledge in the country.
Oh, my dear.
Everyone consults him from the highest in the land. There's no state secret which he does not share. And that, again, is why this telegram is so remarkable.
And I still don't know what's in it.
Here, read it, man.
Must see you about Cadogan West. Coming at once, Mycroft.
Yes, and perhaps you'll be able to tell me, Watson, who this Cadogan West is. You're always buried in the newspapers. The name sounds vaguely familiar, I must confess.
Yes. Of course, Holmes. He's the young fellow who was found dead on the Underground Railway on Tuesday morning.
Ah, found dead. And on the Underground, you said?
Yeah, well, quite literally on it, Holmes. Lying just beside the track outside Aldgate Station. I remember it all now. He'd plainly fallen out of a carriage.
Or been thrown out, eh? Where was he travelling from?
Nobody knows. He didn't have a ticket.
No ticket. Dear me, Watson, this is really very singular. What else is known about him, do you remember?
27 years of age, I think, yes. And engaged to be married. And he was a clerk at the Woolwich Arsenal. The naval office, you know.
Beautifully succinct, Watson. Government employee, eh? So behold the link with Brother Mycroft. Ah, and here comes Mycroft himself, if I'm not mistaken. I know that heavy step.
Sherlock, my dear fellow. This is a most annoying business.
Welcome, my dear Mycroft.
Oh.
Ah, and Lestrade with you, too. The good Lestrade of Scotland Yard. We are honoured.
Your servant, Mr. Holmes. Dr. Watson.
Hello, Lestrade.
I must sit down, Sherlock.
Oh, here.
How are you? How do you do, sir?
How are you, Dr. Watson? You'll forgive us, I'm sure.
Oh, I never have any secrets from Watson, Mycroft.
But this is...
Yes, but you can count on my discretion, sir.
Very well, but... Lestrade, close the door. Make certain no one can be listening.
Very good, Mr. Holmes.
As you know, I dislike altering my habits, Sherlock. In the present state of Siam, it's most awkward that I should be away from the office, but the powers that be would take no denial. I've never seen the Prime Minister so upset, and as to the Admiralty, it's buzzing like an overturned beehive.
Really? And all because of a dead clerk without a railway ticket in his pocket.
You know the facts, then?
My invaluable Watson has just been priming me.
Ah, as much as I could, only what I've been reading in the papers.
What the papers couldn't mention, Doctor, was that if West didn't have a ticket in his pocket, he at least had something else.
Aha.
Some technical papers, Sherlock. And I need say no more than that they were... Lestrade, no one can overhear us?
No one, sir.
The Bruce Partington Plans, Sherlock.
Well...
Great heavens, man, you've heard of them. You must have heard of them. The plans of the Bruce Partington submarine.
I know the name, of course, and of the invention.
Hush, Sherlock, you may take it from me that naval warfare becomes an impossibility within the radius of a Bruce Partington.
Is that so?
Of course, the world has heard of the submarine, but the plans themselves have been most closely guarded. There isn't a foreign power that would give a fortune for them.
Uh-huh.
Under no conceivable circumstances were they to be taken from the office at Woolwich. And yet here we find them, in the pockets of a dead junior clerk in the heart of London.
They've been found, then?
No, Doctor.
But you said that...
10 papers were taken from the safe at Woolwich, and there were only 7 in the pockets of this wretched youth. The 3 most essential are gone, stolen, vanished. Sherlock, you must drop everything to find them.
Indeed, but I may be busy, Mycroft.
Oh, never mind your petty puzzles of the police court. This is vital, international.
Then why don't you solve it yourself? You can see as far as I can.
It's a question of getting details. Give me your details and I'll solve you anything from an armchair. But to run here and there and to cross-question railway guards and to lie on my face with a lens to my eye, you know my methods, Sherlock. No, you're the fellow, the only one in the world. if you were fancy to see your name in the next honors list.
No, really, Mycroft, I play the game for the game's own sake, and on those terms only.
Well,
I'll do what I can.
Oh, thank heaven. Doctor, if you would be good enough to pass over the whiskey and soda.
Certainly, certainly, of course.
Ah, thank you, thank you. Now, Sherlock, the facts, the facts, the facts.
And so Lestrade and I, at first rather silent before those two remarkable brothers, came to hear of the events that had led up to the theft of the vital plans. We learned that the official guardian of the papers had been the famous government expert, Sir James Walter. That there were two keys to the safe. Sir James had one himself, and that he'd spent the fatal night at his home in Berkeley Square, a fact that was vouched for by his brother, Colonel Valentine Walter. The other key was kept by the chief clerk, and he also was at his home that night. We argued, Lestrade and I, that Cadogan West, the traitor, must have obtained a third key.
Yes, that he presumably travelled to London with the papers to sell them to some foreign agent.
And that perhaps a price had not been agreed, and that he'd set off back to Woolwich to return the plans to the safe.
The agent had followed him, murdered him in the train.
And that the most vital of the papers was taken from his pocket and that his body was thrown onto the line.
Well, that's good, Watson. Good, good. You argue admirably, and you too, Lestrade. Yes, as you describe it, it holds together at least. But if you're right, the case is at an end. What is there for us to do, Mycroft?
To act, Sherlock. To act. Of course, the explanation holds together. Yet all my instincts are against it. As I can see that yours are, there are too many circumstances unresolved.
Well, at least it'll serve to break the bleak monotony of this fog. Come along, Watson. And you too, Lestrade.
Yes, we do.
Mycroft, oh no, it's no good asking you, of course.
Yeah.
We'll begin our investigations, I think, by a visit to Olgate Station.
I'll get my coat.
Goodbye, Mycroft. You shall have my report in due course. Oh, before we go, pray write me the names of the most important foreign agents you know to be operating at present here in London.
Very well. There are only three. There are your names.
Thank you, Mycroft. Come, Watson, to Olgate. So then. Fortunately, the fog has lifted a little at last. This is the spot, Lestrade.
It is, Mr. Holmes. That's where the young fellow's body lay. Just there beside the track, where it comes out of the tunnel.
Ah, yes, interesting. Most interesting. Do you notice the presence of anything, Watson?
No. Nothing. Nothing at all, Holmes.
Well, shall I put it then, the absence of anything?
Yeah. Well, there. Ah, of course. Of blood.
Just so. And yet, as I understand it, there was a considerable wound, Lestrade.
The bone was crushed right into the head.
The railway carriage, then, if he was murdered in a carriage, must be covered in blood.
No, Doctor. Every single carriage on this line that night has been examined.
Inside?
Of course. Where else?
Nothing. Nothing. I suppose, Lestrade, that except at a junction like Aldgate here, there are no great numbers of points on a railway system like this.
Oh, I know very few, I'd say.
Yet here there are so many, you see, and all on a curve, just as the lines begin to come out of the station. Well, the case grows in interest, Watson. I must study Mycroft's list of spies in the hansom. Thank you, Lestrade. I shall be in touch with you when Watson and I have paid our little visit.
Our visit home?
Yes, to Berkeley Square.
But Cadogan West lived at Woolwich.
Nevertheless, we visit Berkeley Square. Come, Watson. Our business is with Sir James Walter, the distinguished government expert whose decorations and accomplishments fill at least two whole columns in Who's Who. Good day, Lestrade.
Yet in this case of surprises, we still had one more when we arrived at Berkeley Square. We were ushered into a dimly lit drawing room in the house of the great statesman scientist, and we were joined there by a very tall and handsome gentleman of 50 or so, who introduced himself as Sir James' brother, Colonel Valentine. And from him we learnt, to our distress, that Sir James was dead.
This morning, Mr. Holmes, this morning. You will forgive me, I've hardly recovered from the blow.
I'm deeply sorry, Colonel Valentine, deeply sorry. How did he die, Mary?
It was this horrible scandal of the plans. Oh. My brother was a man of very sensitive honor. The papers were in his charge, you understand. It broke his heart.
Yes, yes, sincerely sorry. We had hoped that he might give us some indications that would help us to clear the matter up.
It was as much a mystery to him as to all of us, Dr. Watson.
He had no doubt, I suppose, that Cadogan West was guilty.
None, sir. Consider the facts, after all. The young fellow and his fiancée were walking to Woolwich Theatre that night. Suddenly, as they were passing the naval offices, he darted away and left her in the fog.
And she never saw him again. Dreadful. But why this sudden disappearance? Can you explain it?
Obviously gone to steal the papers. No doubt some agent had corrupted him. He needed money. He took the papers to London and met his death by some form of double-crossing, as I believe it's known in such circles.
Yes, yes, of course. That's the only explanation indeed.
But you can understand, Mr. Holmes, how deeply disturbed I am.
Naturally, Colonel. Forgive me for having taken up so much of your time already. Come, Watson, we must take our leave. Goodbye, Colonel.
Good day, sir.
Goodbye, gentlemen.
And now, Watson, to Baker Street. Then I shall leave you for a little on business of my own, but we shall meet again later tonight at Goldoni's restaurant in the Gloucester Road in Kensington. You'll join me there at 9, Watson, and kindly bring a jemmy, a dark lantern, and a revolver with you.
It had to be. Once more, Sherlock Holmes was at his most mysterious. I watched him, in Baker Street, pore over a map of London, consulting again and again the list of known foreign agents which Mycroft had given him.
There are numerous small fry, but only three key men worth considering in connection with the sale of the plans to a foreign power. Adolf Meyer in Westminster, Louis La Rothier in Notting Hill, and Hugo Oberstein of Caulfield Gardens, Kensington.
Yet how could Holmes tell which of the three was most likely? In the late afternoon, he went out. The fog was still persistent, although less heavy than in the morning, and just before 9, I made my own way through it, wrapped heavily in a bulging overcoat, and so met him, as arranged, in Goldoni's restaurant, where he'd just finished dinner.
Watson, my dear, infallible Watson, let me offer you a cup of coffee.
No,
thanks. Well, this is quite a singular adventure, Watson. I fear that up to now I've kept you rather in the dark.
You always do.
But the tools I mentioned, the burglar's tools, you've got them
under my coat. That's why I haven't dared to take it off.
Excellent. The proprietor has been so very kind as to present me with this cigar. Do have it, my dear fellow.
No, thank you.
They're less poisonous than one would expect.
Oh, well, thank you. But I'd rather have an explanation.
Well, so you shall. What is it exactly that you want me to explain?
Whose house is it we're going to burgle?
Oh, yes, of course. The house of Mr. Hugo Oberstein at 13 Caulfield Gardens.
What, the third name on your brother's list?
The same. Come, Watson. Waiter, my hat and coat. It is time for us to go.
But how do you know that Oberstein's the one? There were three names on the list.
By the fact that there was no blood beside the railway line at Aldgate Station or in any of the railway carriages of the trains that night.
But, my dear Holmes...
Come, come, it isn't such a mystery. Quite elementary, in fact. It all hinges on the fact that this young man had no ticket in his pocket.
Meaning simply that he must have lost it once he was in the train.
Meaning that he was never in the train at all.
Good heavens.
But consider, Watson, is it a coincidence that the body is found at the very point where the train pitches and sways as it comes round a curve over the railway points? The body was on the roof, Watson.
The roof? The roof? Of course.
He had met his death elsewhere, and then the body was laid on the roof of a carriage, and it rolled off onto the line at Aldgate just as the train swung round. There was no blood, of course, because the murder had been done elsewhere.
Couldn't he have been dropped from a bridge?
Impossible. The carriage roofs are slightly rounded. He was placed.
Placed? Placed? But how? And where?
Barely 100 yards from where we are now.
Huh?
It's a simple matter of consulting a map of London, my dear fellow, as I did, and I found that of the addresses given to us by Mycroft, the only one adjacent to this particular branch of the Aldgate line is number 13 Caulfield Gardens.
Oberstein's house. Oh, splendid, Holmes, splendid. You've never risen to a greater height.
Thank you, my dear fellow. And here, if I'm not mistaken, is the house itself. I've been able to ascertain that Oberstein left hastily for the continent yesterday afternoon, so we plainly cannot call upon him in the ordinary way, and so we shall burgle his empty house for evidence. There seems to be nobody in sight. Are you quite ready, Watson?
Yes. It's not the first time that we've gone housebreaking, is it? We're almost experts. Remember the Milverton case, Holmes? Oh, dash it.
Now, Watson, control yourself. I thought we were supposed to be experts.
Yes, well, the Milverton case was 13 years ago.
Ah, yes, time flies, does it not? Here we are. I fancy this back room's the one we're looking for.
Yes, you were right about the railway, Holmes. It's just below the window.
I thought so.
One of those places where the underground comes to the surface. Deuced noisy house to live in, I'd say.
But a convenient one for the disposing of corpses. Listen, there's a train coming now. You stay there, Watson, and watch how closely beneath the window the carriage roofs pass.
What are you doing, Holmes?
Prowling about, seeing what I can find.
The missing papers, eh?
Of course not. There's someone on the continent by this time. No, anything I can lay my hands on that might serve as a clue. There's a box here.
What's in it, Holmes?
Attend to your own business, man. The train. Push open the window.
Few feet, Holmes. A few feet below us.
Ah, just so. And given the fact that a train pulled up outside there that night, as I've checked they sometimes do, because of an intersection beyond the tunnel.
The thing's simplicity itself. And look, Holmes. Here are bloodstains on the sill.
Oh, you're becoming quite observant, my dear fellow. I noticed them the moment we came in. However, this little box, do you see it?
What's in it?
Cuttings. From the personal column of the Globe newspaper, if I'm not mistaken, judging by the print and colour. As you know, I've made a study of such things.
Hold the lantern, Holmes. Let me see.
Yeah, they're pinned together in consecutive order. It's plainly the way in which Oberstein communicated with his confederate.
Here is he. Yes. Stuff waits you when goods delivered, terms agreed, signed, Pierrot. And here's another. It's the last of them. Look, Holmes. Monday night after 9, 2 taps. Payment in hard cash when commission fulfilled.
Also signed, Pierrot, and Monday night. Significant, Watson. I think that a visit to the Globe offices would not be amiss before we retire for the night. Then a lazy day tomorrow, perhaps, except that you'll have a couple of telegrams to send off.
Telegrams? To whom?
One to my brother and the other to Lestrade, asking them both to meet us in this house here tomorrow evening, just before 9 o'clock.
In this household?
Yes, the front room this time, I think. Yes, the front room.
What I don't understand is why you brought us here to Kensington at this time of night, Mr. Holmes.
To show you the thief, Mycroft. Have you seen the latest message from Pierrot? Show him this morning's newspaper, Watson.
Yes, there you are.
Tonight, same hour, same place, 2 taps. Your own safety at stake.
My dear Sherlock, if he answers that, we've got him.
That's exactly what I thought myself when I put it in.
Unless it was Cadogan West after all, of course, in which case he can't come.
Oh, I fancy it wasn't West. No, no young man would think to leave his fiancée alone in a foggy street while he rushed off to commit a daring robbery. He'd plan more carefully so as to be alone at the time. No, no, no.
No, no, wait, Holmes, wait. Footsteps. Someone's coming to the front door.
Excellent. Do you three hide behind this inner one whilst I go and let him in. Come in, sir, this way. You're expected. Now, Watson, on him! Lestrade, that's your man!
Got him, Mr. Holmes! Got him!
What's this? What's this, I say?
Colonel Walter! Colonel Valentine Walter?
The same. I wasn't quite sure till now if he was the bird we were looking for. Well, Mycroft, Sir James's brother. I should have known. I demand an explanation. I came here to visit Mr. Oberstein.
Of course you did.
And we know why, sir. We know everything.
How any English gentleman could behave in such a manner is beyond my comprehension.
Oh, it's true. Before heaven, it's true. Don't think I haven't hated myself every minute of it. Thank heavens it's over at last.
Colonel Walter, you must have taken an impression of your brother's keys.
Yes. Yes, I was in need of cash. I'd been gambling. I knew I could get money from Oberstein. I went to the Woolwich office that night and I...
Yes, and young West must have seen you and recognized you in the fog as he passed there with his fiancée.
Yes, he'd been suspicious of you for some time. He left his private concerns and followed you like the good citizen he was.
And then I suppose he saw you steal the papers and he came after you to this house and to his death.
Oh! Before heaven, I didn't kill him, gentlemen. It was Oberstein when he rushed to the door and demanded what we were going to do with the plans.
Yes, but you helped to lay him on the roof of the train when it stopped outside.
Yes, I helped. Oberstein made me.
Why did you put the 7 papers in his pocket?
To divert suspicion. To make everyone think it was West who was the thief. Oberstein kept the important ones, the only ones he needed.
Your brother, Sir James Walter, suspected you too. It was that that killed him.
Yes, he suspected too. He saw me with his keys one day.
Now, you have an address for Oberstein on the continent, I presume?
Yes.
You'll write to him then. You'll tell him that you have discovered an important detail missing from the plans he has. You'll say that you can't leave the country yourself, so that he must come back to you. You'll meet him, say, in the smoking room at the Charing Cross Hotel at noon on Saturday next. Will that serve, Mycroft?
Quite admirably, Sherlock. I could hardly have conceived it better myself. I'll be very surprised indeed if it doesn't fetch our man.
And it did. It's a matter of history now. How Oberstein came to the lure and was safely engulfed for 15 years in a British prison. In his trunk were the vital papers, which he put up for auction in all the naval centers of Europe. As to Holmes, I learned not long afterwards that he spent a day at Windsor, whence he returned with a remarkably fine emerald of Taipin. He told me that it was a present from a gracious lady in whose interests he'd carried out a small commission. Then, as he played his violin that evening, his eyes traveled slowly from the pin where it lay on the table to those famous revolver practice marks he once had made on the wall of our sitting room, spelling out V.R. And it required no great effort of his own deductive methods for me to guess the lady's august name. And to reflect that the emerald pin would forever recall to my friend's memory the notable adventure of the Bruce Partington Plans.
Adventures of Sherlock Holmes, based on the original stories of Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, have been dramatized anew with original music composed by Sidney Torch. Sir Ralph Richardson played the part of Dr. Watson, and Sir John Gielgud that of Sherlock Holmes. The program was produced by Harry Allen Towers.
Allen Towers did a lot of work out of London, and this program was one of them, The Adventures of Sherlock Holmes, going back to February 6th, 1955, 69 years ago. Coming up next, Barry Craig confidential investigator William Gargan and The Diary of Death on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox.
Friends, this is Bob Hope. If an atom bomb were to hit your home city, would you know what to do? Remember, one explosion of an atom bomb could kill 75,000 and maim 100,000. This is only one kind of a disaster which could strike. In addition to many forms of enemy action, there are the dangers of fire, flood, earthquake, and traffic. Knowing what to do before, during, and after a disaster can improve your chances of survival. There is something you can do and do now. You can learn a pattern of survival. Your local office of civil defense is ready to help. Persuade your club, your church, your friends, and your neighbors to help to learn to live. Remember, this is the atomic age. No one can escape its hazards, but everyone can prepare. Listen carefully. What you are about to hear can save your life. Do you know the siren signal in case of atomic attack? Do you know how to find shelter? Do you know how to give first aid? Do you know what will be done for your safety? For further details, consult your local office of civil defense.
Oh, and a reminder, all these things you hear is talking about civil defense. If you go to civildefensemuseum.com, civildefensemuseum.com, there's a page there that has all the documents and a lot of the things that they were giving away at the time for free or for reduced cost, and you can get them all free just for download. That's at civildefensemuseum.com. Now on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. William Gargan, starring as Barry Craig confidential investigator, 72 years ago, February 6, 1952, The Diary of Death.
William Gargan stars as Barry Craig, confidential investigator.
There's an old school motto with a modern twist, folks. An empty barrel makes a fine casket.
The National Broadcasting Company presents William Gargan in another transcribed drama of mystery and adventure with America's number one detective, Barry Craig, confidential investigator.
Barry Craig speaking. Manhattan Island's my beat. From Battery Place uptown to Spite and Dilo. I've got my footprints on every inch of sidewalk. A memory in every mile. Get used to a beat and it's like home to you. You're an island native and only a pretty fancy fee can drag you even across the river to Brooklyn or three other boroughs. To drag you out of town needs a major earthquake or an act of Congress. So how come I find myself 40 miles from Broadway in an incorporated village called Seneca on the trail of a claw murderer? A nice little gent with side whiskers like Abraham Lincoln coaxed me into it. Town Supervisor Samuels, he called himself. His pitch went something like this.
I came straight to you from Lieutenant Trav Rogers of your Metropolitan Police, Mr. Craig.
Yeah, Lieutenant Rogers phoned me. You just left his office. No dice, old man. Seneca's off my beat.
But it's a situation of desperate emergency.
What's the population of your village, Samuels?
300.
A killer can't lose himself in that smaller crowd.
But then...
Order every townsman to line up in the public square. Then go up and down the line. When you see a wild gleam, nab him.
A wild gleam?
The guy you're looking for is a lunatic, first class. The claw used in the killing shows that. One nut in a neighborly crowd, your sheriff can't be that helpless.
Well, he is. Berkey's only honorary sheriff. His business is farm tools and tractors.
Who's your regular sheriff?
We have nobody. Crime in Seneca is a rare thing. Don't even have a jail.
Pass the hat and build yourself one. Crime's here to stay, people say.
The board of supervisors empowered me to supersede Berkey, to contract outside help. Someone experienced in homicide. You were highly recommended.
By Trav Rogers. The lieutenant's having his joke.
Please, Mr. Craig.
You're a nice town supervisor, and you look like a tintype of an old favorite uncle of mine. I'd like to help you, but no amount of pleading. No power on earth, not 50 claw killings, can entice me 40 miles from New York. In Seneca, flanked by Samuels and the sometime sheriff, I got a look at the corpse. The morgue was the back room of a taxpayer divided into a grain, oats, and seed shop and mortuary parlor.
This was Dr. Tyler, Mr. Craig.
A doctor, huh?
A horse doctor.
Oh, sad day for Dobbin. Pretty thorough job of annihilation.
Shocking crime.
The claw marks on the skull were made by a garden tool, looks like.
Yeah.
Did Doc Tyler have any enemies? Let the sheriff answer, Samuels.
Why, no. Not to my knowledge, he didn't. Doc Tyler was a pillar in the community, a fine, respected
Save
man.
Save the eulogy for the funeral services, huh? Theft, then. Was anything stolen?
No, I'll have to say no to that. All Tyler had was accounts receivable. Bills owing him for his doctoring work.
You went over his property, then?
I did. The robbery was my notion, too, at first. I ordered an inventory of everything Tyler owned, right down to the horse bills.
And nothing was missing?
Nothing of any account, no. Except for old Baldy, everything was right where it belonged.
Except for old Baldy, you say?
Huh? Old Baldy's an old iron paperweight, the American Eagle. Doc Tyler always had it on his desk on top of a pile of papers.
And old Baldy was missing?
Yes. Yes, we couldn't find hide nor hair of it. Well, either somebody borrowed it and plans to keep it now that Tyler's gone, or Tyler threw it out.
Or the murderer clawed Tyler to get it.
Oh, now, why would anybody want to commit murder for a worthless old paperweight?
Can't say. But that's why I'm in this whistle stop, to find out why.
And that brings us down to cases. You and me.
Come again?
Your being here. Samuels brought you out against me.
Against you?
No, Sheriff.
Shut up, Samuels. This is between me and Craig. Against me, I said, Craig.
Oh, I get it. Your pride's hurt, huh, Sheriff?
When you've jackassed around a while and Samuels admits to being the finicky fool he is, I'm marching you to the railroad station.
With a brass band and local school mom doubling as drum majorette. A big goodbye to a conquering hero, Sheriff, because my parting gift to Seneca is your claw murderer in person. Want a bet? I found overnight accommodations at a Miss Pringle's split seconds before a storm broke. Miss Pringle was a spinster who looked it, and a fluffy white poodle who looked as if he was eating himself into his grave to escape Miss Pringle.
This is Fluff, Mr. Craig.
Fluff, huh? Does he bark?
Seldom. Fluff has chronic laryngitis.
Oh.
Dr. Tyler, peace to him, was treating Fluff.
Sad about Dr. Tyler.
You're here to find the fiend?
I'm here to get a night's sleep.
Very well. You can have the attic room.
Why so high a climb?
Well, I'm not accustomed to taking male lodgers.
An upset. Blankets, towels, is everything there?
Oh, yes, yes, the room is ready.
And a wall outlet so I can plug in and shave?
No, the electric wires don't extend to the attic.
Oh.
There's a kerosene lamp. Now, if you go to your room...
You're pushing me, Miss Pringle.
But I'm not accustomed to men in my parlor.
An upset. I'll see you in my dream.
Oh, my.
Good night, Miss Pringle. There were things I wasn't accustomed to, like attics, like figuring out how to light kerosene lamps, or like having the roof suddenly cave in on my head. I went down from a sneak blow, a club the weapon felt like. I went down, but not out. I could see through a red haze like a film of blood, and I could hear glass breaking somewhere in the room. I rolled on the floor, not to be a sitting duck for a second blow. But no second blow came. Just quiet and the rain outside. The rain blowing in from an open window. The window my sneak opponent had used getting in and out. I went out the window after him. Outside, just at the edge of Miss Pringle's driveway, I ran into a reasonable facsimile of King Kong. A guy who looked as if he should be swinging from trees. Sitting behind the wheel of an open convertible, its top down. Working the car starter and getting nowhere. Having trouble, friend?
It's slow, don't want to go.
The wires are wet.
I'm driving good and then it stops.
Your wires are wet.
I'm driving good, and then it stops, and then it won't go.
You're getting all tangled up in your IQ, friend. Doesn't the top go up?
Yeah, easy. This button here, you push it.
So push it.
No.
You've got a medium-sized lake around you. Floodwaters rising from the floorboard.
I'm not pushing no button. I like it like this.
How did you happen to stall here?
I told you I'm driving good.
And then it stops, and then it won't go.
You making fun of me?
No. Did we meet a while ago?
Huh? Where?
In Miss Pringle's attic.
No. I'm driving, so how could it be?
How could it be? Parked here the last 5 minutes. Did you see anybody in a hurry to quit the general neighborhood of Miss Pringle's?
No. I see nobody.
You're sure?
Are you trying to mix me up?
Nature got to you first. Just for future reference, what name do you answer to?
Harmony.
Harmony?
Yeah. You like it?
Back in the attic with the kerosene lamp lit and Miss Pringle in a trembling spasm, I took stock of the room.
Oh, what you've told me, Mr. Craigie, it's unbelievable.
Believe it. I wasn't born with this rhinoceros egg on my head.
But what purpose could
I'm checking to see. This picture on the floor, where was it hanging originally? The kerosene lamp's throwing so many shadows, I can't see the nail hole.
Why, it hung there over the highboy. The glass broke?
Yeah, it needs a new glass. A ship's print, huh?
Yes, the Princess Ida, an old whaling vessel.
The picture have any special meaning?
Special meaning?
A value, an heirloom or something?
Why, no. No value. I only paid $1 for... Oh, wait. Yes, come to think of it. I was offered a good price for it.
How good a price?
$100, if I recollect.
For a dollar print? Who made the offer?
The young Mr. Stanley. The one with the new antique shop out on North Rugby.
Why didn't you sell the picture to him?
Well, I'm not sure. For spite, I guess.
Spite?
Well, the young man was too persistent and bad-mannered. Calling me on the telephone and then tracking his muddy boots on my parlor rugs. But I don't understand why these questions.
Somebody was up here to steal the picture. I got in the way and was struck down.
But nobody stole the Princess Ida.
It was dropped in the commotion and the getaway. I heard breaking glass while rolling on the floor.
Oh, you're trying to frighten me.
Just enough to make you twice the cautious miss you already are. No men in your parlor. There's one joker abroad who might not respect that rule.
Oh, you're not alluding to the claw murderer?
Bolt your door and sleep with one eye open.
Oh, my...
I've just found you beautiful, and I don't want to lose you.
Mr. Craig.
Yes, Miss Pringle.
There's a fine room on the first floor right next to mine.
Oh, no thanks. I'm getting to like the attic.
There's electricity and a wall outlet you can shave.
Oh, really kind of you. But I'm looking forward to roughing it. It'll toughen me up.
Mr. Craig, I insist you move to the room downstairs next to mine.
Oh, this creeping infatuation for me. Fight it, Miss Pringle, to your last drop of blood. We could get to be the talk of Seneca.
But I don't care, Mr. Craig. I'm frightened.
In the morning, I took breakfast with Town Supervisor Samuels. Breakfast and information.
I'm sorry, Sheriff. Berkey made you unwelcome.
Berkey's sensitive to competition.
I'm sorry about your injury.
My injury?
You were attacked and beaten last night.
How could you know?
Miss Pringle had me on the telephone in the middle of the night.
Oh. I want to know about a couple of your townspeople.
Eh?
First, a bright chap who calls himself Harmony.
Harmony? Now, what reason could you...
Never mind. I'm asking the questions. Tell me about him.
Harmony's big Toby Keller. Hires out for odd jobs. Spring plowing, window washing, garage work.
How about dirty work?
No. Craig, you're wrong about Harmony. I'd take an oath. His mind isn't the best. But we know him to be good-natured, honest.
Mm-hmm. What about a young Mr. Stanley?
Fred Stanley? He's a newcomer to Seneca.
What brought him here?
A lawyer got him to come in the first place. From Chicago, I think. Chicago. Fred Stanley came thinking he was a missing heir. Claimed his grandfather's fortune.
But there was no fortune.
Only an old house just this side of the Seneca line. Not worth the taxes on it.
Why was there any idea of a fortune at all?
The grandfather, old Mitchell Stanley, was said to be a rich miser who put no trust in banks. When Mitch Stanley died, there wasn't a penny. They had to auction off his furniture to pay for his funeral.
But young Stanley stayed on in Seneca.
Opened an antique shop in the old Stanley house.
Can he make out in a one-horse town like this?
He has business signs posted on the highways, hoping to get the tourist trade. What's your interest in Fred Stanley?
He tried to buy a ship's print, the Princess Ida, from a girlfriend of mine, Miss Pringle. Stanley offered $100 for a picture worth $1. A liberal offer like that...
Craig!
No, don't blow your gasket. It's only a parcel delivery through your closed window. Did you order this?
What is it?
A claw. A garden tool like the one used on Doc Taylor. And a note with it. It's addressed to me, Barry Craig. Get out of Seneca by 10 this morning or never.
Get out of Seneca by 10?
9. I've got an hour of grace.
Or never. Craig, it's a threat against your life.
I'll be planted in the country. A city fellow like me.
The handwriting.
No handwriting. The note was put together with newsprint. Can I borrow your car?
Of course.
Stanley's antique shop is on North Rugby Road, just this side of the Seneca line, you said.
It's a 3-mile drive, up the incline to Widder's Ridge, then left a quarter mile... Craig, be careful. Please, I don't want your murder on my conscience.
Okay, I'll stay alive, but only for your sake, mind you. Staying alive is a deal that sometimes needs the cooperation of unknown parties, in my racket anyhow. Climbing the steep incline to Widow's Ridge. Climbing maybe 300 feet into morning mists as thick as pea soup. I knew I wasn't going to get that kind of cooperation. A rifle shot that blew a tire into confetti. Crash off the incline had to come. Funny distortions in your eye when you first come to and start taking inventory to see if you're alive. A half-frozen robin who didn't have the sense to fly south for the winter. He sat on the side of the hill 10 feet from where I lay, staring solemnly at me and chirping prayers for my safety. Oh, when I started getting to my feet, the robin flew away. The inventory added up. I was all there in one piece with a few dents that couldn't hurt forever. Samuel's car was down at the foot of the incline, topsy-turvy like it was playing dead dog. I'd been thrown clear of the wreck. Half my fee into the poor box. I took an oath on that as I started for Rugby Road on foot. Fred Stanley gave me the expected answer.
Just what do you find so unusual about my interest in buying old pictures, Mr. Craig?
$100 for a $1 picture doesn't make sense.
And why must it make sense?
It's a cold, practical world, chum. People generally don't go haywire with money. They conserve it.
Now look, Craig, I collect Americana. Whatever strikes my fancy, I buy. The cost is secondary.
But you're in business to buy cheap and sell at a profit.
Technically, yes, but it doesn't work out that way. I love buying and I hate selling. A profit is rare.
That gets expensive. Where does the money come from?
That's none of your business, Craig. Now, if you don't mind, I'll terminate this interview.
I'm in no hurry.
Now, look here, Craig.
And I'm in no mood for the polite, formal approach, Stanley. Or the kind of weasel talk you've been giving me. Or being terminated.
Are you insane?
I walked away from my own murder 20 minutes ago. I came to this whistle stop against my will to do a big, good deed. And go home. I don't intend to settle here for keeps.
But what has that got to
do... You lied to me. A fancy, eccentric pose that's as phony as a ham board of an acting shemokin. The ship print signifies something more than just another antique. No polite, formal approach, Stanley. I'm going to pound the truth out of
you. You're crazy! Let me go!
Tell me about the Princess Ida ship print.
Let go! Harmony! Harmony, help!
Harmony, huh? Now we're making headway. So King Kong's hired out to you.
Harmony, help!
I want you to let Stanley go.
Strapping ape like you, Harmony, you don't need a gun to take charge.
I want you to let Stanley go.
Sure, I'll let Stanley go. I was only fixing his tie.
Oh, Craig, you had no right to manhandle me, no right.
It paid off. I got to find out who was providing Harmony with his raw meat.
Harmony's with me on day hire. To do general cleaning and polishing, scrape down old furniture.
Plus prowl in attics, plus distribute garden tools shaped like claws all over town. Plus take rival shots at passing cars.
You're out of your mind. You assaulted me and Harmony rescued me. Now get out of here.
Sure. But I'll be back. I'll be back, Stanley. The minute I tumble to your motive. Back at Miss Pringle's to wash up and change my suit for a whole one, I found her prized parlor rug a mess. Spots all over it. And the dog Fluff suddenly cured of laryngitis and barking. Warm spots with a sticky feeling to the hand. Red like blood. Blood tracked in by Fluff from somewhere. I followed the tracks to Miss Pringle's bedroom. The blood was Miss Pringle's goodbye to spinsterhood. The garden tool shaped like a claw lay beside her on the floor like a third hand. Town Supervisor Samuels, aged 20 years and 20 seconds.
Craig, it's ghastly, ghastly.
We'll skip the rhetoric. Miss Pringle was murdered by someone who made off with the Princess Ida.
You know that?
The picture is gone. I searched high and low.
The murder then clears Stanley and Harmony of any suspicion?
No.
But you saw them
Miss
both.
Miss Pringle could have been murdered earlier, while I was here, breakfasting with you. The Princess Ida and old Baldy. Two murders for two worthless relics.
You're convinced these relics motivated the atrocities?
It figures. The relics and somebody's lust to kill for its own sake. We're dealing with a nut to boot. Do the articles have any history?
History?
A story, some legend they figure in, say.
No, nothing I know, Craig.
Some background that could tell us why two hunks of junk produced two killings.
I'm sorry.
Is there anybody in Seneca who could know? A village librarian or a local historian?
You could ask Will Briggs. Will used to be our recorder until the town board voted to abolish the job.
Will Briggs?
Will is crotchety, bad-tempered. I don't think he'll be disposed to help you, even if he could.
Even in a town crisis like this?
Will Briggs don't feel very civic about Seneca and its problems. Since we abolished his job for economy reasons, Will's been feuding. Suing the courts for pension, making a rumpus at town hall meetings.
Great cooperative little town you've got here. Great job you roped me into. But Will Briggs pulled a switch on Samuel's characterization of him. Briggs fell all over himself cooperating.
For $20, Mr. Craig. I am a man without funds.
$20, okay. You'll get it.
black-hearted board of supervisors...
Did you dirt? Old Baldy and the Princess Ida. Scratch your memory.
Old Baldy and the Princess Ida. Funny now you should be asking about them.
Why is it funny?
You're the second party that's come to me asking.
Who came first?
Old Mitchell Stanley's grandson. The one who settled himself into a shop here a spell ago. Young Fred Stanley.
What did you tell him?
What I'll tell you, if you wait. I have the record here. Yes, here it is. The sales sheet, my own writing, for that auction they held at Mitchell Stanley's once to raise money for burying him. I was craking for the auctioneer that day.
Get to it, please.
In my time. See? It says here we sold beds and tables and floor coverings. Down here it says Old Baldy, 50 cents. Sold to Dr. Tyler. Princess Ida, $1. Sold to Miss Pringle. And the snowman sold for 75 cents.
What's the snowman?
The design on a patchwork quilt it's named for.
Who bought it?
Let me see. Sold to Adam Samuels, it says. That's the town supervisor himself.
Where's your telephone, Briggs?
Telephone? He ain't never invented it from its use to me. Keeping body and soul together as it is.
Briggs, don't bend my ears.
What's got your backup?
Samuels, your town supervisor's number 3 on the claw murderer's list.
If it's so, I say good riddance to the black-hearted...
Good riddance or bad. Someone else would have to judge Samuel's merits as a human on Earth. The garden tool shaped as a claw lay across the room where it had been thrown. A claw with bright red fingers. Fred Stanley resisted arrest to the last gasp. Harmony's last gasp, that is.
Craig, get out of here.
You're under arrest, Stanley.
You have no authority.
I've got a gun.
Harmony!
That ape man comes through the door and he's dead.
Harmony!
You're asking your moronic stooge to commit suicide?
We'll see. Harmony!
One down, and Seneca's a better place for it.
You killed him.
He's only wounded. Where do you want it, Stanley?
I'll go with you.
Stanley put his confession on record after a little workout and a lot of sweating.
I found a diary that once belonged to my grandfather, Mitchell Stanley. A diary hidden behind the oak paneling over a fireplace. In the diary, 3 pieces of a map were mentioned.
A piece each hidden in Old Baldy, the Princess Ida, and the snowman, huh?
Yes. A treasure map. The 3 pieces were to fit together into a treasure map. Through them, I'd find the wealth my grandfather was reputed to have. The wealth that never turned up when he died.
Insanity runs in the Stanley line, huh?
My grandfather's whole genius was a genius for hiding and hoarding. Hiding from the world in that awful house at the edge of the town line. Hoarding his gold. Fantastic thing like a child's treasure map was well in character with my grandfather. The shabby trick, too, was well in character with my grandfather.
What does that mean?
Well, it was all a grotesque joke. My grandfather's ghoulish sense of humor. I killed 3 people for a load of junk. There weren't any pieces of map in Old Baldy. Or the Princess Ida, or the snowman.
That diary, Stanley. Give it to me.
Here, go hunt yourself up some treasure, Craig.
There was an anticlimax to the Stanley story. In the village beanery, with the sometime Sheriff Berkey trying to act apologetic and yet keep his dignity...
I suppose you'll be leaving now, Craig.
Yeah, I can't wait to stand on Broadway and flip a cigarette into the gutter.
Well, I've been a jealous fool.
So would I be, in your shoes.
Oh, thanks. Will Briggs is coming over to see you. He says you owe him something.
Yeah. $20 for valuable services rendered.
Craig?
Briggs.
It's not out of order now.
To dun me for $20? Here you are.
I'll thank you when we go.
Stick around a minute, Briggs. I want to go over that feud you had with the town board.
I'm over it now.
Now with the town board extinct, now that the murders of Doc Tyler, Miss Pringle, and Samuels have left Seneca without a town board...
I'm not one to pillory the dead.
But I'm one to pillory the living. Here's that alleged Mitchell Stanley diary that produced 3 murders.
Is it now?
And this is that auction sales sheet in your own handwriting, as you told me. Do I have to tell you that the handwriting in both is the same, even down to the green ink?
Craig, what are you getting at with Briggs?
That Briggs here forged the diary, Sheriff, and planted it where young Stanley would be sure to find it. That Stanley killed 3 people Briggs hated, while Briggs sat back and enjoyed the show. That young Stanley was only a dupe, a tool used for revenge. Make the arrest, Sheriff. And then flag down a train so I can scram out of this whistle stop. The sweet neighborliness around here is just killing me. Good night, folks. See you next week.
You have been listening to William Gargan in another exciting transcribed mystery drama from the adventures of Barry Craig, confidential investigator. Tonight's story, Diary of Death, was written by John Robert. Next week, it's the strange story titled A Time to Kill, about which Barry Craig has this to say.
Next week, I have a wow of a time in the kindergarten when a whimsical corpse insists on playing hide and go seek. See you next week, folks.
Featured in the role of Samuels was Louis Van Ruten. Barry Craig, starring William Gargan, was under the direction of Hyman Brown. This is Don Pardo speaking.
From 72 years ago, February 6, 1952, Barry Craig, confidential investigator, here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Up next, Inner Sanctum Mysteries and the Creaking Door. 79 years ago, February 6, 1945, Death in the Depths.
This is basic civil defense information from the Department of Defense, Office of Civil Defense, Washington. If our nation ever comes under nuclear attack and you take shelter to protect yourself from radioactive fallout, water is the key emergency supply. Each person will need at least a quart a day, and if there's not enough water stored in your shelter, here are additional places to find it, especially if you plan to use a home shelter where you'll be on your own. Local authorities may instruct you to turn off the main water valve. When you do this, the pipes inside the house will still be full of water. Next, turn on the faucet located at the highest point in your house to let air into the system. Then use water from the faucet located at the lowest point in your house. You can also use water in your hot water heater, in the flush tanks, or water in ice cube trays, milk, soft drinks, canned juices. If necessary, you can even drink water that's been exposed to fallout. However, very young children should be given non-contaminated liquids when available. For more information, consult your local civil defense office.
And if that sort of thing interests you, check out civildefensemuseum.com. That's civildefensemuseum.com. Now, let's open the creaking door for an episode of Inner Sanctum Mysteries from 79 years ago, February 6, 1945, Death in the Depths.
Lipton Tea and Lipton Soup presents Inner Sanctum Mysteries. Good evening, friends of the Inner Sanctum. This is your host, Raymond, inviting you once again to join our scary company. Please come in, won't you? We have a the full quiver of shivers this evening, and, what? You say it's rather cold in here. Well, some of the chills of our story must have leaked out. Why don't you all huddle together? There's so much comfort in having someone else beside you instead of being besides yourself.
Now, Mr. Raymond, that's no way to welcome people. You're apt to chase them away talking so scary-like.
What? Oh, hello, Mary Bennett. So, you don't think I'm a good host, huh? Maybe I should say, lay your little head on a pillow. Are you comfy? There. Now, Uncle Raymond will drone you to sleep with a bedtime story. And when you wake up, Aunt Mary will give you a nice hot plate of Lipton's noodle soup.
Oh, dear. There's just no talking to you. Folks, please don't listen to the way he talks about Lipton's noodle soup. Try it for yourself. You just don't know how good noodle soup can be until you've tasted Lipton's. It's got such a grand chickeny flavor. It really tastes homemade. And then, of course, Lipton's noodle soup comes in a package, so it's no work to prepare. You just empty it into boiling water, and in a jiffy, soup's on. And another thing, Lipton's makes lots more and costs less than canned soups.
Well, thanks for the hot facts, Mary. And here's a fact for you. Did you know that more than two-thirds of the Earth's entire surface is unknown? The salty wastes of the sea? Only a short distance under the surface, death lurks in 100 different shapes. And that's where we're going to take it tonight, in Robert Newman's strange story of Death in the Depth. A wharf in a small seaside town a few minutes before midnight. Moored to the dock, just barely visible through the thick fog, is a stubby, broad-beamed ship. Suddenly, out of the swirling mist, a man and woman appear. He is tall, heavy-set, carries a sea bag over his shoulder. She's slim, attractive. They reach the end of the dock, and he stops, his face haggard. I can't do it, Leela. I just can't. That's all there's to it.
Stop arguing and get on board there.
Well, I'm telling you, I can't, Leela. I can't. Why even think about it? The way the water looks down under. Feel of it. Pressing against
you. And I'm telling you that you are going, whether you like it or not. 2 years of living in crummy second-rate rooming houses. That's plenty, see? Too much. You're going back to doing something that really pays off.
Leela,
I told you to shut up. Now stop squawking and let's go aboard.
Okay. Hi there, the Gasker Bay. Is Captain Brody around?
I'm Brody. Come aboard.
Evening, Captain. My name's Sparrow. This is my wife.
Hello.
I understand you're going off on a job and you're looking for divers.
Well, yes, I am. We've got a salvage job off the Keys. It's a tough one, 20 fathoms. We only use real deep water men. What did you say your name was again?
Farrell. Steve Farrell.
You mean Big Steve Farrell? Why don't you say so? Sure, I can use you. Wait right there. I'll go get the paper.
Okay, Captain.
Well, was that so tough?
Hey, look, for heaven's sakes, don't make me do it. You don't know what you're asking me to do it. It's like sending me... Leela. Did you hear that? Nine bells.
What of it?
What of it? There's no such thing as nine bells. It's like a clock striking 13 o'clock. Well, it means death. The only other time I ever heard it was when Curly...
Listen, I'm getting sick of this, see? You don't want to do any more diving because you've lost your nerve. And because a bell rings nine times instead of eight, you say it means something. Well, what do you think it would mean if I told the police a couple of things I know? I'll tell you. It would mean the chair. Now, how do you like that?
Leela, you don't know. You don't know.
Take care of yourself, Stevie boy. I'll be seeing you in a couple of weeks.
Feeling pretty good, aren't you? I think you're getting just what you want. Well, maybe you are. Because when I sign those papers, I won't be signing on as a diver. I'll be signing my own death certificate.
All set, Captain. Any instructions before they close me up?
No, Steve. Can't expect much on a first dive, but see if you can determine the extent of the damage. All we know about her now is that she's about 1,500 ton. Her name was the Santa Elena. She went down the collision.
Right, Captain.
Okay, close them up. Start the pumps. Lower away.
I'm scared. Scared. I swore I'd never go down again. But here I am. It's all just the way I remembered it. Nothing at first but the quiet. Just the pumps like the echo of your heart beating. And the light fading as you go down. Getting darker. And the cold. The pressure building up. Pressing harder and harder. Gripping you tighter and tighter as if you were being swallowed by something alive. Always down below where you can't see it. Something weighty. Something that... Stopping. Not a stopping. There was a time when I really used to like diving. When did it all begin? Despair. Yes, that night in the bar in Tampa. She told me she married Curly.
Well, this is certainly quite an evening you're giving me, Steve. It's more like a wake than a celebration. Why are you looking at me like that?
I'm wondering whether I should kill you. Whether I should talk to Curly and let him do it.
What do you mean?
You know what I mean. You know Curly. If you ever found out how things were with you and me, well, he's just young enough and crazy enough about you to put you away for keeps.
I can handle Curly with my little finger. Besides, you wouldn't do anything like that.
Wouldn't I? Why'd you meet me here tonight? You know it's because you wish you were married to me instead of him.
So what? What are you going to do about it? You know darn well he'll never let me go.
No. I guess he won't, but... We've got to do something.
Yeah, but what?
After all, he wakes for me. Diving's kind of dangerous. As a matter of fact, we're getting off on a job tomorrow that's pretty tricky.
Steve.
When you want something badly enough, there's always a way of getting it. Yeah. That was the beginning. That wasn't when I was afraid for the first time. That came later. 2 days later, out on the reefs. 2 days of being with Curly and talking to him. Knowing all the time what I was going to do. And that last dive, late in the afternoon. Standing on deck with Andy, the pump man, and watching Curly through the clear water. Watching him move across the deck of the hulk. As cool as she was, and...
You going down too, Steve?
Yeah, Andy. Maybe we can wind up today and start home tomorrow. You can handle both of us?
Sure. Only watch the coral over on the port side there, sharp as a razor. Almost took Curly's boot off this morning. If you get into any trouble, well, I'm all alone up here.
I'll watch you. Want to button me up?
Yeah, sure.
Down now. But I still wasn't afraid. Not yet. I was too busy figuring out just how I was going to do it. And landing on the bottom and starting to wake my way toward the hulk over the coral. There was Curly's hose and safety line. Lying on the coral. Snaking its way to the hulk where he was working. I didn't have to look up. tell by the shadow I was under the hull of my ship, so Annie couldn't see me. Then I came to a place where Curly's line was lying right next to a coral spur. And I knew that was it. I bent down, looked it around the spur so Andy couldn't pull him up.
Hello, Curly. Curly, try your line. I think it's fouled.
Then I did it. Took out my knife and cut Curly's air hose. Andy must have known it even before Curly did. As soon as the bubble started pouring out of the end of the hose.
Hello, Curly. Can you still hear me? I think you're in trouble. Your airline's cut. Hold it and save whatever air you got. Steve's on the bottom, too. He'll get over to you. Did you hear Steve?
Yeah. I heard. I'm going as fast as I can.
Steve, you gotta hurry. Where are you?
I just hit the deck, but it's clouded up and I can't see anything. Where's Curly?
Up forward to the ship's bell. Listen, he says he's going to ring it so you can follow the sound. And for heaven's sake, hurry.
Follow the sound? As if I didn't know where he was. Straight forward. I could see him now, his lifeline taut, so he couldn't move. Holding his air hose with one hand and ringing the bell with the other. He was swaying back and forth. And I started counting the strokes. 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Then he slid down onto the deck. The air bubbled out of his helmet, and I knew he was dead. I remember thinking, 9 bells. 1 bell after midnight. Then suddenly it came over me that this was something I was never going to be able to forget. Never. But every time I went down, I was going to see him swaying there, hanging on to the bell, waiting for me. Waiting.
So that's why Steve Farrell wouldn't go back to his old profession of deep sea diving. I should think it would lose some of its appeal if you expect to meet a dead man every time you go down. How about that, Mary? Climb aboard and tell us what you think.
Well, Mr. Raymond, I certainly wouldn't like to be a deep sea diver. To be all alone down there in the cold water with fishes and all sorts of things swimming around you. That's not for me.
Oh, but just think, Mary, when you come up, you could have a nice hot plate of Lipton's noodle soup.
I think you've really got something there. Lipton's noodle soup would sure be welcome at a time like that. It's such a heartwarming dish. It perks you up just looking at it. Looking at those tender noodles floating in that golden broth. My, I'm getting to talk fancy. But really, folks, Lipton's does taste sort of special. It's got a chicken-y flavor. And it just tastes homemade, like the old-fashioned noodle soup you used to make yourself. But heavens, I don't want to be interrupting Mr. Raymond's story, so I'll just say, try Lipton's real soon, won't you, folks?
Now, shall I go on with the story of death in the depths of the sea? And that strange underwater world where dead men ring their own death knell on the bells of sunken ships? Okay. It's just a moment later now. And Steve Farrell is still standing on the deck of the sunken freighter, Santa Elena.
Oh, Steve, anything the matter?
Why, no, Captain. I'm sorry. I thought I heard something funny, and I guess I lost my nerve for a minute. After all, this is my first dive in quite a while, but I'm okay now.
You sure? We can haul you up, send Mike down.
No, I'm okay. I'm going to stay.
Well, all right, but don't forget, we can't see you from up here. So keep talking all the time so we'll know exactly where you are and what you're doing.
Check. I'm up forward now on the port side of the deck. I'm just going inside. The companionway door is jammed shut, and I'm working on it. There she is. And now I'm inside in the car door. It's pretty dark. I'm switching on my light. I can see now, a little way ahead of me at least. It's all kind of queer.
Queer? How?
Just funny, strange. She's canted over on her starboard side, so the car is tipped over at an angle. Sort of like a dream where everything's turned around. Kind of different and still familiar. Why does it seem so familiar? seems to remind me of something else. That's it. The corridor of the hotel right after we were married. Walking down it with her, Leela. Out onto the terrace. The way she took the cigarette I gave her. Smile at me. Very sure of herself.
Thanks, Steve. Thanks a lot.
Why the smile, baby?
Why shouldn't I smile? I'm young, healthy, and I'm married to a guy I like. A guy who's going to take real good care of me.
I sure am, baby. Not only that, from now on, things are going to be different. Didn't have a chance to tell you before, but I'm through with diving. For keeps.
What do you mean?
Just that. I sold a boat yesterday and all the equipment. I'm out of that racket for good.
You shouldn't have done that, Steve. Not without talking to me about it first. What do you expect to do from now on?
Oh, I'm all set on that. I got a job as a second engineer in a freighter, the Arcturus.
Well, I guess that'll be all right. For a while, anyway.
What do you mean, for a while? You think you're going to tell me what kind of work I should do and what kind I shouldn't do?
But of course, Steve. Like I said, I'm your wife. And besides, if I wanted to, I could tell either you or anyone else a lot of other things. Like why you decided to give up diving.
What are you talking about? Give it up because I was sick of it.
Is that the reason? Or is it because you're afraid that if you did do any more diving, you might start to... seeing things.
Seeing what?
Well, after all, you were right there when Curly had his accident and got drowned. The funny thing is, you were talking about how he might have an accident just before you went off on that trip. I've been thinking I really ought to talk to Andy about it since he was there, too, and find out just how it happened.
Andy's not around anymore. He left town right after I paid him off.
Oh, I see. Well, remember that the police could probably find him, Steve, if they should ever want to ask him any questions.
Steve, what's the matter? Why don't you answer? Where are you?
I'm sorry, Captain. Nothing's the matter. I guess I was just thinking about something else, and... I'm at the end of the corridor now... just open the door to the engine room. I'm going across the gratings now and down the stairs. Funny. Something kind of familiar about all this. Pattern in the grills. Picture the stairs. Captain, what did you say the name of this tub was?
Santa Elena. Panamanian registry, I think. Why?
She kind of reminded me of another ship. The Arcturus. The Arcturus. What made me think of her? I know why. A year and a half in which I almost forgot about Curly. What had happened down there on the deck of the schooner. A year and a half in which I was almost happy, even with Leela. And that night, the night McHenry came up to me when I was on watch in the engine room.
Hi, Steve. How are they going?
Swell, Chief. I just cut number 2 in again, and she's burning like a kitten.
Good. Look, Steve, the old man claims he's handling a bit heavy. He wants us to sound out the pumps and check the bilge. I told him he was crazy, but, well, maybe we'd better.
Okay, Chief, I'll get on it right away.
Anyone around to give you a hand?
I don't really need any help. But if I want him, Swanson's I have someplace.
Well, report to me as soon as you're finished.
Right, Chief. Oh, there you are, Swanson.
Hey, where you going? Come back.
Wait. Wait a minute. You're not Swanson. Who are you?
I'm nobody, Chief.
Stowaway, huh? Hiding down here behind the boiler.
Give me a break, will you, Chief? I ain't doing nobody any harm. Where I'll be. Steve. Big Steve Farrell.
Andy. Andy Andrews.
And I wanted a break. This is terrific, Steve, like money in the bank.
What happened to you anyway?
Oh, usual thing, run of tough luck. Been out of work for about a year now. Look, Steve, I'm pretty hungry. I ain't had nothing to eat since we left port.
I guess I could pick up some stuff from the galley for you. But you'll have to be careful. Be the devil if they found out I was hiding. Good old Steve. I know you wouldn't let an old shipmate down. And, Steve, while we're at it, I could use a little cash, too.
Yeah, yeah, I figure that.
Well, when we get to port, I guess I could let you have 10 or 20.
That's not enough. I was figuring on, like, 500 for a starter.
500? Are you nuts?
I don't think so, Steve. You see, after Curly had his little accident and you sold the boat and all the equipment, I figured you'd given up diving because you were kind of upset about it. Then I heard you'd married his widow, that Leela Dame. I started thinking back. I remembered how Curly's air hose looked after we pulled him up. The place where it was cut wasn't rough, like it had been done by Coral. It was clean, like it had been done with a knife.
You.
So that's it. Blackmail. Oh, why do you have to use words like that, Steve?
Okay, Andy. It's gonna be a little tough to get, but...
Wait a minute.
What is it?
Someone's coming, one of the wipers. We gotta find some place for you to hide. I know. Down there in the bilge. Here, climb in. Right down through that
window. But it's almost full of water.
There's plenty of room and you'll be safe there. Really safe.
Oh, okay, but you better not... Oh, what are you doing?
All
right. Let go of me! Let go! Help! 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 Help!
You'll be safe here, all right. I'll see to that. Stop struggling like that, Andy. It's not going to do you any good. And I'm in too deep already to
let you go wandering around with what you know. And weeks before they find you down here in the bilges.
Maybe they never will. And if they do, they'll figure you tried to hide down there and got drowned all by yourself.
Steve, will you talk up and stop mumbling? Where are you now?
Down at the bottom of the ladder in the engine room. This light's not too good. The boilers are right in front of me, and there seems to be some kind of a brass plate on the floor here.
Captain, this isn't the Santa Elena. It's the Arcturus.
What are you talking about?
It is. Don't you understand it? It's the ship where I killed him. And he must still be down here. Down the bilges. Get me out of here. Pull me up.
Okay, Steve. Now take it easy. We'll get you up. Start hauling him up. Mike, you better go down there fast. See what the trouble is.
Hurry up, for heaven's sake. I think I see something moving back there. Behind the boilers. Hey, Brody. Looking like it did when Curly. That means that he's here, too. They're both here. Can't you get me out?
We're trying, but something's wrong with your line. Seems to be fouled. Now, look, Steve. Try to get out yourself. Start working your way back along your line.
No good, Steve. You know that, don't you? You're here to stay.
Andy. It is you.
Sure, Steve. And I got a friend with me. A friend of yours, too. He's standing right next to you.
Andy.
We waited a long time, Steve, but now you're here with us. And now you're going to know exactly what it was like with both of us. You're going to know what it's like to drown.
Steve, why don't you answer? What's the matter? Steve, your lifeline and air hose, I think they're gone.
Hey, Curly, no. Let me go.
It's too late, Steve. This is it. This is the way it was with us. Trying to fight it first, holding your breath. Then, when you can't fight it any longer, letting go. The water rushing in, into your mouth, nose. You choke at first, try to fight some more. Then everything starts to go black, and you relax. There are lights moving in the darkness, and suddenly you feel very peaceful and very free. Peaceful and very free.
Did you find him, Mike?
Yeah, he was right where you said, down in the engine room.
They're hauling him up now.
It's going to be tough breaking the news to his wife. How did it happen?
There's a heavy iron door leading into the engine room. It swung shut, cut his lifeline and air hose.
You're saying an awful lot of stuff that didn't make sense, but there was something about a bell.
Well, his lifeline was looped around the bell on the foredeck. Must have gotten caught when you tried to pull him up. And that may have rung the bell a few times. There was something else, though. You remember you said he kept asking if the ship's name was really the Santa Helena?
Yeah.
Well, there was a brass plate in the engine room with her original name on it. And it was the Arcturus. They must have changed it when they re-registered her.
That is funny. There's one thing that's even funnier. Well, of course, the whole thing was an accident, but I wonder what made that door close.
Oh, you do, huh? Even with two able-bodied ghosts about? But that's the way we like to leave you, with a couple of things to keep you wondering. And when we do, then we've known we've really rung the bell. The funeral bell.
Oh, Mr. Raymond, with all the different kinds of bells there are, why do you have to talk about that kind?
All right, Mary. Pick your own bell. See if I care.
All right, then I'll choose a dinner bell.
Will you ring it 9 times?
No, sir. You only have to ring it once if you're serving Lipton's noodle soup. And folks will come swarming to the table because they know it takes Lipton's to show how good a noodle soup can be.
Now, before I close the inner sanctum, here's a word of advice. If you should have nightmares tonight about drowning men and wake up with a start and see a strange figure in your room, a figure with staring eyes and seaweed in its hair, dripping water on the floor, don't be alarmed. Just ask it for its haunting license. Brother. By the way, this month's Inner Sanctum mystery novel is Net of Cobwebs by Elizabeth Sanxay Holding. Now it's time to really close that squeaking door. Until next week at this same time, when Lipton Tea and Lipton Soup present another Inner Sanctum mystery, directed by Hyman Brown. So until then, good night. Pleasant dreams.
Folks, I don't know how you feel, but that spooky bell gave me the shivers. Right now, I'd like to hear a cheerful sound that'd make me forget all about it. Yes, I'd like to hear a tea kettle singing on the stove. And when that water is at a good rolling boil, let's have a cup of Lipton tea. You know, the tea with the brisk flavor. That word brisk, B-R-I-S-K, means that Lipton's has a lively, full-bodied flavor. It never tastes flat or wishy-washy. So don't forget Lipton tea. And don't forget to tune in next Tuesday night for another Inner Sanctum Mystery.
This is CBS, the Columbia Broadcasting System.
Years ago, February 6, 1945, Inner Sanctum Mysteries here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Up next, Jack Webb and a West Coast program, 1 out of 7.
Civil Defense has now located fallout shelter spaces for more than 165 million people. But that still leaves many millions to go before we reach the ultimate goal of fallout protection for everyone. We can build to that goal not by constructing expensive special shelters, but by simply making sure that fallout shielding is built into new schools, apartments, industrial and municipal buildings, that will be put up in the next few years. That way, we can gain additional fallout protection in new buildings without wasting space, at little or no additional cost. For more information, consult your local civil defense director.
Or consult civildefensemuseum.com for all that same information. Jack, and this is not a particularly good recording, but I think it's instructive to hear how back in the day, people who were, out of the norm got handled on a show like Jack Webb's. Jack Webb's show, 1 out of 7, 1 day out of the week. 78 years ago today, February 6, 1946, the story of a very, I can say it, he was a very ugly man, Senator Theodore Bilbo.
Ladies and gentlemen, the material and direct quotations included in the following program have been taken from authoritative files and from dispatches filed by the Associated Press and International News Service. We present these statements without editorial comment. We assume no responsibility for their content.
The American Broadcasting Company presents 1 out of 7. Make a day, 7 days make 1 week. And from these past 7 days, the editors here in our San Francisco newsroom have chosen the one story which they have judged most worthy of retelling. This is 1 out of 7.
Theodore Gilmore Bilbo is an honorable man. As a member of the United States Senate, he is looked upon as such by the eyes of the law. Perhaps he is looked upon as such by many or most of his constituents. Though his voice occasionally grate upon the nerves, and his views often confound the innocent, the fact remains, as a member of the Senate of the United States, Theodore Gilmore Bilbo is an honorable man. And we do not intend to prove otherwise. We merely wish to cite a few samples of his handiwork, and perhaps a supplementary side glance or two, just for the sake of contrast. Adjust your dials most carefully, citizens. Herewith presenting Senator Theodore Bilbo, picture number 1. Scene. The Chamber of the Mississippi State Legislature. Time, March 23rd, 1944. The Speaker.
The Chair recognizes us distinguished guests, the Honorable Theodore Bilbo, United States Senator from the state of Mississippi. Gentlemen, at this moment, I cannot urge you too strongly to continue the valiant fight to uphold our racial integrity. We must renew our faith and allegiance to the color line. For your information, I have found that certain Negro organizations are determined to secure passage of anti-poll tax measures. It's their first wedge toward the fulfillment of a dastardly equality program which Negro leaders have launched throughout the South and throughout the nation. That equality they must not and will not attain.
After his stirring appeal to the legislature, Senator Bilbo informs a small group of friends in confidential tones.
You know, gentlemen, I found out that a prominent national official asked southern colleges and universities to open their doors to Negroes. You know what I told them? Well, I'll tell you what I told them. I told them, I said, Negroes are never getting into our universities. You Negro-loving Yankees can go straight.
As a member of the Senate of the United States, Theodore Bilbo is an honorable man, and we do not intend to prove otherwise. Here is picture number two. Hello. Senator Bilbo speaking.
Senator, this is Representative Mark Antonio of New York speaking.
Yes, yes. What do you want?
Senator, I just got a letter from a lady who lives in my district. It seems that she wrote you that letter about your filibustering against the FEPC. Well, she says she stated her case fairly. And she also says that as a reply, you wrote her one of the dirtiest letters possible.
Well, yes, I think I did.
Well, Senator, she also says you addressed her with the greeting, "My dear Dago." Is that correct?
Of course that's correct. That's what I called her. She's a wop, ain't she?
That lady's Italian, Senator. Yeah, that's what you mean. I just thought you'd like to know that the lady has three brothers in the army in Europe. One of them has been killed in action already. You know, if you had a shred of decency in you, you'd apologize for that letter.
I'll never apologize. Why, she's getting off light. Now, listen, she really would have been scorched if I was mad. Theodore Bilbo is an honorable man. We do not intend to prove otherwise. Here is picture number three.
Scene: the chamber of the United States Senate. Time: the 30th of June, 1945. Senator Bilbo is filibustering against passage of the Fair Employment Practices Commission, and during his prolonged dissertation to the gentlemen of the Senate, the following occurs.
The senator from Mississippi may continue.
Thank you. Gentlemen, I have been hearing much talk about the supposed bravery of our Negro soldiers. I have it on good authority and from some of the highest ranking generals in our army that our Negro troops overseas are an utter and abysmal failure. They're just no good. And as for giving them a vote, why, they'd only sell their votes to the highest bidder anyway. So why give it to them in the first place? At the same moment, deep in the jungle of an embattled Pacific island, a Negro soldier pens a note back home to his family.
And maybe this works pretty hard, Margaret, but it's a job that you just have to do. It's been 3 days now, and no sleep. Their bombers are still paying us visits. And it still doesn't look like the war's going to be over soon. But we have to keep on. Just keep on. I know. I just know everything's going to turn out all right. And when we finally get back, the folks will realize what we've done. And I'll bet they look at us differently. You know, for the first time, they'll see that bullets can kill anybody. They'll see, black or white, when blood runs out on the ground, it's all the same color.
That's what the Negro GI thought. But back in the chamber of the United States Senate, Theodore Bilbo thought differently.
I have it on good authority and from some of the highest ranking generals in our army that our Negro troops overseas are an utter and abysmal failure.
When Senator Bilbo made that statement, he was standing under the roof of the United States Senate. It is very safe in the United States Senate. A bomb hasn't fallen there for quite some time. You must understand, please, this is merely a portrait, an interesting portrait, of a duly elected representative of the American people. For you see, Theodore Bilbo is an honorable man. and we do not wish or intend to prove otherwise. Here is picture number 4. Though the senator has firm convictions on certain subjects, there is seen a mounting tide of sentiment equally firm, equally convinced that the senator errs. On the 10th of August, 1940. Senator Bilbo, it is the opinion of the Committee of Catholics for Human Rights that your conduct toward racial minorities is a chilling deterrent to worldwide belief that America is the symbol of democratic freedom and human rights. In a recent statement to the press, you attacked the Jewish people of the United States on the grounds that their race had damned and crucified Christ. You used this highly metaphysical argument to damn, vilify, besmirch, and otherwise persecute the Jewish people in America to further your own political ends. By lucid contrast, a few days after his attack on the Jews, Senator Bilbo is stricken suddenly with a strange ailment. He is put aboard a train and speeds northward for treatment. And is it not strange that the senator demands to be taken to the Mayo Clinic? Is it not strange when you consider that the Mayo Clinic was founded and operated by the Mayo Brothers, two members of the Jewish race professing the Jewish faith? But obviously, the senator is not loath to take advantage of the skill of the Jewish race. In the end, the senator's critical operation is a success, and in a few weeks he returns to the floor of the Senate with another plan for the American Negroes.
Gentlemen, for the best interests of the nation and all concerned, I believe a colony for American Negroes should be established on the west coast of Africa, bordering the state of Monrovia. Because of the exigencies of the times, any Negro who is race conscious and smart should be ready and more than willing to settle down in such a colony in West Africa.
The very same day in the halls of the Senate, hallowed by the figures of men the likes of Lincoln and Jefferson, Theodore Bilbo, as a representative of the American people, had this to say.
I cannot vote for the appointment of Mrs. Franklin Roosevelt as delegate to the United Nations Organization for the United States. No. She is a woman who has professed friendship for the Negro elements in America. She has no place representing us abroad. Mr. President!
The chair recognizes the senator from Idaho.
Mr. President, I should like to congratulate the senator from Mississippi. He doesn't know it, but he just paid a splendid compliment to Mrs. Roosevelt by voting against her. Mr. President, gentlemen, please, I'd like to add one more note. A word of warning to our senator from the South. It isn't going to be long now, Senator, before the people of Mississippi see the light and knock you out of office on that part of your anatomy where your few brains are undoubtedly located.
You must understand, please, this was merely a portrait, an interesting portrait of a representative of the American people. For, after all, Senator Theodore Gilmore Bilbo is an honorable man. He is looked upon as such by the eyes of the law. He is an honorable man. We did not intend to prove otherwise.
The script for One Out of Seven is written by James Edward Moser. Gil Dowd is the producer, and music by Otto Clare at the Hammond Organ. The material used in tonight's program was taken from authoritative files and from dispatches by Associated Press and International News Service. Listen next week, same time, same station, for One out of seven. This is ABC, the American Broadcasting Company.
The show only was a seven-week show on KGO and possibly on the West Coast network of ABC. But we only have four or five of the shows. One on the Third World War, one on the anti-Negro South, and one entitled Free Men. And I have to tell you, when you look at the show, you realize it shows that Jack Webb was more than just Joe Friday. One out of seven from 78 years ago, February 6, 1946. And think in these 80 years how far we've come. Alrighty, Lum and Abner continues up next as we see what's going on with Diogenes Smith. That's up next.
How much time do we have? Minutes, days, months, years? We don't know. But this we do know. Civil defense is everybody's business. Just what is civil defense? It's your answer to beat the A-bomb. Civil defense is the way of saving lives and property. It's the way to protect you and your family in case of enemy attack on the United States. It's the way of helping you to keep going in spite of attacks with atomic or biological warfare or chemicals or conventional weapons. The aim of the enemy would be to make you and me and others quit our jobs so that our defense plants would have to shut down. Our aim, then, is to keep working because we must give to our armed forces the things they need to win. We must prepare now. How much time do we have to prepare? We don't know. But this we do know. Civil defense is everybody's business. It's your business.
And you can learn about it by going to civildefensemuseum.com. They don't pay us anything for this. It's just a mention of something that good to have if you listen to this information. Now on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox, let's head to Pine Ridge, Arkansas. See what's going on in the household of Lum and Abner and the Jot 'em Down store. This is from 82 years ago, February 6, 1942.
The makers of Alka-Seltzer bring you Lum and Abner. Friends, I'm pretty sure you know a lot of folks who have colds because they're mighty prevalent these days. And say, maybe you have one yourself. If so, I think you'll like this way to relieve for your distress. Start at once to take Alka-Seltzer according to the directions inside each package and see how it eases that dull, aching, feverish feeling. And be sensible, too. Get more rest than usual, stay out of drafts, dress comfortably, and get your daily quota of vitamins. Also, if your cold causes a sore throat, well, Alka-Seltzer can help you there, too. You just dissolve two tablets in a quarter glass of warm water and use it as a gargle. We believe you'll find it pays to use Alka-Seltzer for relief of your misery when you have a cold. Get Alka-Seltzer from your druggist and keep it handy all the time. And now, let's see what's going on down in Pine Ridge. Well, since Diogenes Smith offered $10,000 for the person who'll be judged the most honest, kind, and helpful during the next 3 months, everyone in Pine Ridge has turned over a new leaf and is striving to become a model citizen. As we look in on the little community today, we find Lum in the Jot 'em Down store discussing the matter with Mousy Gray, the delivery boy. Listen.
Gee, $10,000. Do you really think he'll give away that much money, Lum?
Why, of course he will, Mousy. He said he wouldn't if there one feller that tells the truth or ought to be. It's Diogenes Smith. Honesty's the main thing in his life.
Yes, sir. Gee, $10,000. You know, Lum, $10,000 would be just like a mother to me.
Well, naturally, it'll be like a mother and a papa and six or seven uncles to me.
And to get it, you just have to be picked as the most honest man in the community. Is that all?
Yeah, the most honest, kind, and best lender of the helping hand.
Yes.
But now, don't think that's easy. This contest, or whatever you want to call it, goes on for 3 months.
Yes, sir.
That means you got to be honest and all them other things every minute of the time. Because you never know when you're being watched. You see, Dodge and Easy has pinted 5 fellers to help him keep watch on everybody. Nobody knows who they are.
Yes, sir, I know that, Lom.
Oh, you do? Wait a minute. You ain't been picked out as one of the help... No, I reckon you couldn't tell me no way. Dodge and he swore his helpers to secrecy.
Yes, sir.
Well, you better get out with the delivers, Mousy. It's getting late.
Yes, sir. I'll go right now.
And, Mousy, just in case you're picked out as one of the helpers, don't forget how honest and fair I've been in all my dealings with you.
No, sir, I won't. Well, I'll be back soon, Lon.
Yeah, wonderful world, Mousy.
Wonderful world, Lon.
Hello, jot 'em down, store and library, Lumetter's talking. Wonderful world. Oh, hello, Miss Seastrunk. Huh? Oh, yeah, we got some awful good flour. Best you can get, Well, to be honest, it ain't the best. Facts is, Miss Seastrunk, it ain't very good at all. No, Mom. You can get some a heap better over at Dick Huddleston's store for the same price.
Well, howdy, Long.
Yes, Mom.
Oh, excuse me, never seen you on the phone.
Oh, that's all right, Miss Seastrunk. You can always depend on us to tell the truth about things. Oh, all right. Goodbye. Ma? Oh, yeah. Wonderful world. Granted, I don't know about this honesty stuff, Abner.
Dog, is everybody in town sure excited over it?
There, huh?
Oh, yeah. You ought to see how everybody's acting. They all go around saying wonderful world and trying to be nice and kind and honest and stuff.
Oh, yeah. There ain't no doubt that Dodge and Easy's turned this town upside down.
Yeah.
Soon as he announced that $10,000 prize, everybody got on their best behavior right away. I noticed that.
Yeah, he made a change in Snake Hogan.
Snake Hogan?
Yes, sir.
Well, Granny, he can't win the prize. Not a mean feller like him.
Well, he's trying for it, though. This morning he got mad and beat up on a feller, and then he picked the feller up and apologized to him and brushed his clothes off for him.
Well, I do know. I didn't know he'd improve himself that way.
The best one, though, Sister Simpson, Lum. She's trying awful hard for that honesty prize. Mose Moots overheard her tell Diogenes that she was 57 year old.
57?
Yes, sir.
Why, she ain't never admitted to more than 35, long as I can recollect.
I know it.
Well, once I believe she did get up to 36, but then she dropped right back to 32 for several seasons.
Yeah, well, she's 57 now. Said it herself. I dog as I believe this Dodge and these fellers doing Pine Ridge a heap of good, Lum.
Oh, yeah, it ain't no getting around it. Them's good rules for right living he set up for us.
Yeah.
I don't care who you are. I just wished I knowed who the 5 helpers was, though. Make it a heap easier to measure up to them rules.
Well, nobody ain't supposed to know who they're. Dodge and these don't want you to know.
Yeah, no. Listen, Abner, don't say nothing to nobody about it, but I sort of suspicion Mousy's one of them.
Mousy Gray?
Yes, sir.
Ah.
Yes, sirree, sir. I was talking to him about it just before you come in, and whilst he never come right out flat-footed and admitted he was, he never denied it, neither.
Well, I do know.
So I don't think it'd hurt none for us to be sort of nice to Mousy.
Yeah, yeah.
Lend him the helping hand and all.
Yeah, don't worry. I'll be nice to him. I'm proud you told me that, Lum. Reckon Mousy'd like to have his shoes shined every day.
More than likely he would, but don't make it too plain that you're trying... Wait a minute.
What's the matter?
Oh, no. Thought I seen Squire heading this way, but he cut across the street there.
Oh, dog, there's one fella we don't need to worry about getting the honesty prize. He wouldn't have a chance in the world.
Oh, Squire's got so many black marks against his character, he knows better than to even try for it.
Sure.
I reckon he wishes now he'd have led a more honest kind of a life.
More likely he's madder than a wet hen because he ain't got no chance at that $10,000.
Well, what he'll do is wait till somebody wins it and then try to trick him out of it. That's his way of doing business.
Snake in the weeds.
Wait a minute. Wait a minute. Look who's coming up out there.
Huh? Oh, dodging it.
Yeah.
Still toting that lantern, ain't he?
Yeah. Now, try to keep from making any more of them ignorant remarks in front of him this time, Abner.
I never said no ignorant remarks.
Well, howdy do, Dodge. Wonderful world, Dodgeny.
Wonderful world, Mr. Edwards. Wonderful world, Mr. Peabody.
Wonderful world, Dodgeny.
The seed has been sown, friends. The seed has been sown, and already is bearing fruit.
I don't say you went into the farming business, Dodgeny.
Ah, Yes, farming. Yes, I'm a farmer of mankind. Fields of honesty, acres of kindness. Wonderful world.
Wonderful world.
Wonderful world.
Ah, your citizens. How they've reacted to my plan. Everyone striving for the truth. Everyone becoming generous. Lending the helping hand. Everyone except one man.
Yeah, I reckon we know who you mean, Dodge. We were just talking about him before ever you come in.
Yeah, that old squatter.
Hush, hush. Mention not names. Let us be charitable in all our acts.
Oh.
We'll soon overcome the stragglers. Let us be happy with the wonderful results we've achieved in 2 days. Think what we'll have when the 3 months are done. A utopia. A model village.
Good for us.
And then the germ of honesty will spread to nearby villages, thence to the cities, thence throughout the whole world. Ah, friends, at last my work has found a fertile field. Now I must work harder than ever. Now I must use all my... What's in that room back there?
Oh, that's our feed room. Keep sacks of feed and hay and stuff like that.
Oh, that's too bad. I thought perhaps it was empty. You see, I need a place to work, a place to write my pamphlets, a place to print them, send them flowing into the channels of the world.
Well, we'll fix it up for you, Doc.
You have need of the room.
No, we don't. I'll have Abner clean it out, or I'll clean it out.
I'll clean it out, Lon. Be proud to do it, Doc.
Well, your persistence has won me over, friends. I shall take the room as my workshop. But I shall pay you well for it.
Oh, no, we wouldn't think of letting you pay for it. You can have it for nothing.
Why, sure you can. We don't want no money.
No, I must pay for what I get. We all must pay for what we get.
Yeah, but not for this, Diogenes. We want to lend the helping hand.
Of course we do. We're awful kind and honest, too.
Oh, yes, you are. What course does your kindness leave for me but to accept your generous offer? And I shall move in as soon as my little printing press can arrive. My little but mighty voice of honesty.
Well, good. You can get your printing press here just as soon as you can, Dodgenes. And anything else we can help you with, why, just let us know.
Yes, sir, especially if you got any honest work to do.
Oh, kind friends. Your offers shall not go begging. And I must leave you now to send for my printing press. But I shall soon return with a bottle of pickles.
A bottle of pickles?
Yes. A kind, honest old lady in Shelby, Ohio, once gave them to me.
Well?
Fine woman. Well, I must leave. Wonderful world, friends.
Wonderful world, Arjun.
Wonderful world.
Granny, he's a curious sort of a fella, ain't he?
Yes, sir.
Sometimes he almost seems a little touched.
I can't keep up with him.
And he's a good man, though.
Oh, yeah, there ain't no good in him, no, sir.
And I think we made a good impression on him by giving him the feed room to work in.
Yeah.
I believe me and you just practically win that $10,000 already.
Oh, yeah. You can tell how he acted when we said we didn't want nothing first. Wait a minute. There comes Squire back across the street. Looks like he's coming in here this time too, Lon.
Granny, did you hear Dodge and these tell how Squire weren't following none of them right living rules?
Well, he never said it was Squire, Lon.
No, but I know that's who he meant.
Oh, yeah, more likely.
Found you old Squire's the maddest feller in town right now.
Yeah, look how he's stomping in the store.
Yeah.
Well, howdy, Squire.
Yeah, how are you today, Squire?
Well, gentlemen, glad to see my good friends.
What can we do for you, Squire?
Oh, I just dropped in to pay you this little grocery bill I've been owing you for several years, Lum. Yes, here you are. $69.72, I believe that's correct.
Well, I'll swan to goodness.
And, Lum, here's an extra dollar, too. That's to cover several cans of tobacco I've taken when Cedric was in the store alone here. I don't know for sure, but I think he might have failed to put it down on the book, so keep a dollar. Well, good day, gentlemen. Good day. Wonderful world.
Wonderful world, Squire.
Wonderful world.
Well, Diogenes Smith is causing a sensation in Pine Ridge, isn't he? And folks, listen to this sensational announcement by the makers of Alka-Seltzer. There's a new one-a-day vitamin tablet. It's the one-a-day brand vitamin B complex tablet. Yes, the same brand name as the famous one-a-day vitamin A and D tablets so many of you are taking every day. But the new tablet contains an entirely different group of vitamins, the vitamins of the B complex. That's right, there are now two kinds of one-a-day vitamin tablets. There are vitamin A and D tablets, and also vitamin B complex tablets. Now, the vitamins of this new B complex tablet are just as important to you as the A and D. The body cannot get along and maintain its normal activity without B complex vitamins. When the supply of these B vitamins becomes low, certain warnings are given out which have been described as loss of appetite, subnormal growth in children, nervous irritability, digestive disturbances, and certain skin troubles. These symptoms, of course, do not always indicate vitamin B deficiency, as there are many other possible causes for any of them. But they are an indication of the importance of getting an adequate amount of these vitamins. So play safe and be sure you get your basic requirements, not only of vitamins A and D, but also B complex. Now, one-a-day brand vitamins make it both easy and economical because, and listen, just one of each, once a day, is all you take. Just ask your druggist for both one-a-day vitamin A and D tablets in the yellow box and one-a-day vitamin B complex tablets in the gray box. Look for the big one on each package, will you?
The Squire's trying to at least get around on this. 82 years ago, February 6, 1942, Lum and Abner here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Comedies tomorrow with Jack Benny, Bob Hope, Burns and Allen, People Are Funny, You Bet Your Life, The Great Gildersleeve, and Claudia. That'll be coming up on our Wednesday, Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Have yourself a great day, and we shall return mañana.